Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would ask the media to please withdraw. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome all of you, colleagues, committee members, Madam Justice Karakatsanis, Mr. Justice Moldaver, Professor Hogg, ladies and gentlemen, to this important and, I believe, historic event. À cette occasion, des députés aiguisant au nom de tous les Canadiens pourront engager un dialogue avec deux candidats à la nomination à la Cour suprême du Canada, selon un processus que le Premier ministre a exposé dans son annonce de 17 octobre 2011. At that time, the Prime Minister announced that the two nominees would appear at a public hearing of an ad hoc committee of parliamentarians to answer questions of members of Parliament. Cette procédure a été suivie auparavant lors de la nomination de juge Marshall Rothstein à la Cour suprême du Canada en 2006. This public hearing is intended to bring greater openness and transparency to the appointments process by allowing Canadians to learn more about those individuals who will be appointed to the Supreme Court of Canada. The selection process began after Mr. Justice Ian Binney and Madam Justice Louise Charron announced on May 13, 2011, that they would be retiring from the Supreme Court. In keeping with the announced process, I consulted with the Attorney General of Ontario, senior members of the Canadian judiciary, as well as with prominent legal organizations, including the Law Society of Upper Canada. The purpose of this consultation was to identify a pool of qualified candidates for appointment to the Supreme Court of Canada. Members of the public were also invited to submit their input with respect to qualified candidates who would merit consideration. A list of qualified candidates was then reviewed by an appointments selection panel composed of five members of Parliament from the government and recognized opposition caucuses as selected by their respective leaders. The members were Mr. Bob Deckert, Ms. Candace Hepner, Mr. Grant Rathberger of the Conservative Party, Joe Comartin of the New Democrat, and the Honourable Erwin Kotler of the Liberal Party. The panel was tasked with assessing the candidates and providing an unranked list of six qualified candidates for the Prime Minister and I for our consideration. To help ensure a full, balanced, and objective assessment of the candidates, the members of the panel met to review the resumes provided by each candidate, as well as a number of reported judgments and publications. The members of the panel also consulted with the Chief Justice of Canada, the Chief Justice of Ontario, the Attorney General of Ontario, the Law Society of Upper Canada, and the Canadian Bar Association. The list of six candidates, which included the two nominees, was unanimously approved by the panel. Avant de présenter les candidats à la nomination, j'aimerais traiter de quelques questions de procédure qui régiront la séance d'aujourd'hui. First, as was the case with Mr. Justice Rothstein's hearing, we will begin with an opening statement from Professor Peter Hogg, who kindly agreed to join us today to speak to us on the constitutional framework that informs our deliberations today, and on the Canadian traditions governing the proper limits of judicial speech. This will be followed by opening remarks from each of the nominees. There will be then two rounds of questioning by committee members of up to 8 minutes and 5 minutes, respectively. As chair, I will be responsible for enforcing these time limits. This proceeding will end with concluding remarks by Professor Hogg and I. Secondly, I would like to inform our members and guests that parliamentary privilege does not apply to these proceedings, as this is technically not technically a parliamentary committee. This means that the protection from defamation does not apply as it would normally in parliamentary proceedings. But I have complete confidence that you will use your good judgment accordingly. Finally, I would like to remind you that these two eminent members of the Canadian judiciary will be responding to our questions in a manner that reflects the independence and impartiality of our justice system. This means that some questions may not be answered fully or at all. Professor Hogg will explain the appropriate scope of questions and the constraints on judicial speech for us shortly. I would ask that we, as committee members, respect the parameters within which our nominees are able to respond. Now, I have the great honour and privilege today of introducing two outstanding jurists as the government's nominees to the Supreme Court of Canada. Madam Justice Karakatsanis and Mr. Justice Moldaver, both of the Ontario Court of Appeal. I will begin with the introduction of Madam Justice Karakatsanis. She received her Bachelor of Arts in English Literature from the University of Toronto in 1977. She attended Osgoode Hall Law School and was called to the Bar of Ontario in 1982. From 1983 to 1987, she practiced primarily in the areas of criminal and civil litigation as a partner in the law firm of Sotos Karvanis Karakatsanis. In 1987, she left private practice to become vice chair and later chair and chief executive officer of the Liquor Licensing Board of Ontario, where she served until 1995. That same year, she had joined the Ontario Ministry of the Attorney General and assumed a variety of posts, ultimately that of Deputy Attorney General from 1997 to 2000. Madam Justice Karakatsanis went on to serve as Secretary of the Cabinet and Clerk of the Executive Council until November 2002, when she was appointed to the Ontario Superior Court of Justice. In March 2010, she was elevated to the Court of Appeal. She has extensive experience in administrative law and spent a number of years actively involved in administrative justice education and reform issues. Prior to her appointment, she also volunteered extensively with the Greater Toronto YMCA, where she served as chair of the board of directors. Mr. Justice Moldaver received his Bachelor of Arts from the University of Toronto in 1968 and graduated from the University of Toronto Law School in 1971 as the gold medalist. Mr. Justice Moldaver was called to the Bar of Ontario in 1973 and was appointed a Queen's Counsel in 1985. Prior to his appointment to the Supreme Court of Ontario in April 1990, he specialized in criminal law. He also served as co-chair of the Canadian Bar Association, Ontario Advocacy Symposium Committee, was a director of the Advocates Society and a member of the board of directors of the Advocates Society Institute. In addition, he was a council member of the University of Toronto Alumni Association and served as co-chair of the University of Toronto Academic Tribunal. While in private practice and on the bench, Mr. Justice Moldaver lectured extensively on criminal law issues, sharing his expertise with new judges, as well continuing to lecture in a variety of continuing education venues. He was elevated to the Ontario Court of Appeal in December 2005. I will now introduce Professor Emeritus Peter Hogg. Professor Hogg is the leading constitutional law scholar in Canada. He was educated at the University of New Zealand and Harvard Law School. He received his call to the Bar of New Zealand in 1962 and taught in New Zealand and Australia before coming to Canada in 1970 to teach at Osgoode Hall Law School in Toronto. Professor Hogg was called to the Bar of Ontario in 1973 and received his Queen's Counsel designation in 1980. He was also Dean of Osgoode Hall from 1998 to 2003. He is presently the Scholar in Residence at Blake, Castles and Graydon. He is the recipient of many honours and awards, including the Law Society Medal and the Companion of the Order of Canada. Je demandera maintenant au professeur Hogg de nous donner un aperçu de cadre constitutionnel qui précède à la tenue de cette séance. Thank you, Professor Hogg, and I turn the floor over to you.
Thank you, Minister. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As the Minister has explained, I am a constitutional lawyer, and it's my role to make some opening remarks to the committee and to provide some guidance for your proceedings. I might say that I'm speaking also to the general public because I'm well aware that the people sitting around the table know very well what they are doing. I think we should say some things that will be helpful for everybody who's listening. This is the second occasion on which a government nominee for appointment to the Supreme Court of Canada has been interviewed in public by a committee composed of members of Parliament. The first time occurred in 2006 when an ad hoc parliamentary committee considered the nomination of Mr. Justice Rothstein. Some of you were on that committee. The purpose today, of course, as the Minister has said, is to consider the nomination of two candidates, Madam Justice Karakatsanis and Mr. Justice Moldaver, both of whom are now judges of the Ontario Court of Appeal. This process, which of course we're only doing for the second time, has not been without controversy. There are people, many of them in the legal profession, who fear that a parliamentary review of judicial appointments carries more risk than benefit. The critics argue that an open process will tend to politicize the judiciary and publicly embarrass the distinguished people who are nominated for appointment. I have no doubt that there are still some people who feel that way, but the proceedings of the committee in 2006 should have greatly reassured the critics. Although the questioning of Mr. Justice Rothstein covered a very large swath of ground, the Canadian virtues of civility and moderation were always on display. The hearing reflected great credit on the members of the committee, whose perceptive and courteous questions demonstrated that a parliamentary committee could make a valuable contribution to the appointment process. I have always been a believer in this process, and I have no doubt whatever that we're going to have a very good hearing today. Let me say something about the role of the committee. The actual authority to make appointments to the Supreme Court of Canada is possessed by the Governor and Council. That is prescribed by the Supreme Court Act. So these appointments will have to be made by the Governor and Council. The Governor and Council will act on the advice of the Prime Minister. This committee is charged with providing advice to the Prime Minister. He has undertaken to take into account the deliberations and views of the committee in deciding whether or not to proceed with the appointment of Justices Karakatsanis and Moldaver. So the committee has the task of interviewing the two candidates to determine whether they are well qualified to serve on the court. Obviously, the questions put to the candidates should proceed from an understanding of the role that is played by a judge of the Supreme Court of Canada, and I want to say something about that role. Judges decide cases by finding the facts that are relevant and applying the law to those facts. But in the appeals that reach the Supreme Court of Canada, there is a complication in that the law itself is usually unclear. That's usually why the case went up to the Supreme Court of Canada. So that in that case, the judges are in a sense making new law because they have to decide what the law is as well as how it applies to the facts of the case. Before each appeal is heard, the judges are required to read and digest an enormous amount of material. They read the decisions of the lower courts, the ones that are under appeal. They read at least some of the transcript of the evidence at trial. They read the decided cases that are arguably precedents for this case, for that particular appeal. They read the articles by law professors that bear on the issue. And they read the factums, those are the briefs of argument, that are filed by counsel for the parties on both sides of the case and by persons who have intervened in the proceedings. And then, after the appeal is heard, the judges listen to oral arguments of all parties and interveners, and they test those arguments by asking questions. After the hearing, the judges discuss the case among themselves and deliberate on their decision. The Supreme Court decides about 75 appeals each year. Every one of them involves the reading, research, listening, and deliberation that I've just described. And of course, the court has to reach a decision on each appeal and then write an opinion. The court of nine judges is usually unanimous, but in a minority of cases, the court is divided, and one or more dissenting opinions have to be written. So it is a very heavy workload that we require of our Supreme Court judges. Let me say something about questions today. As the minister said, the protocol that was followed in the hearing in 2006 will be followed again today, and that means that the committee members are free to ask any questions at all. However, when you think about the role that the candidates will be called upon to play, and here I'm just repeating the minister, if they are appointed, it becomes obvious that there are some questions that they cannot be expected to answer. The most obvious category is that a judge cannot express views on cases or issues that could come before the court. Any public statements about issues of that kind might leave the false impression that the judge had a settled view on how to decide these cases without knowing what the facts were, without reviewing all the legal materials, and without listening to and weighing the arguments on both sides. That, I think, is the main category that the nominees will feel unable to answer questions about. But, of course, the committee is not precluded from and will receive answers, no doubt, about general questions about how the nominees reach decisions. They're both experienced judges, of course, how they interact with colleagues, their professional lives and work, and any other matters that, in your view, bear on their ability to be a wise member of our highest court. The main thing that the committee can and should do is to satisfy itself that both these persons have the right stuff to be a judge of the Supreme Court of Canada. Do they have the professional and personal qualities that will enable them to serve with distinction as a judge on our highest court? Without limiting the scope of your questions or your deliberations, let me suggest seven qualities of a Supreme Court judge that you might want to think about as you listen to their statements and ask them questions. A judge has to be able to resolve difficult legal issues, not just by virtue of technical legal skills, but also with wisdom, fairness, and compassion. A judge must have the energy and discipline to diligently study the materials that are filed in every appeal. A judge must be able to maintain an open mind on every appeal until he or she has read all of the pertinent material and heard from counsel on both sides. A judge must be independent, willing to decide a case according to his or her own view of what the law requires, without regard to whether the decision is pleasing to the government of the day or to other private interests. A judge must always treat the counsel and the litigants who appear before him or her with patience and courtesy. A judge must be able to write opinions that are well-written and well-reasoned. And my last point, a judge must be able to work cooperatively with 8 colleagues to help produce agreement on unanimous or majority decisions and to do his or her share of the writing. Ladies and gentlemen of the committee, if today you find 2 people with those qualities, the nation will thank you and the Prime Minister will have an easy choice ahead of him. That concludes my remarks.
Thank you, Professor Hogg. And as agreed to, we'll hear from the nominees themselves. And so I don't know if you've decided among you who will go first. If you leave it up to the chair.
I think we're going to reserve on that, Mr. Minister. I think we...
Yeah, I think I'll proceed according to seniority and ask you, Mr. Justice Moldaver, to begin.
All right, thank you very much. And thank you, Minister Nicholson, for your very kind introductory remarks. I must tell you, though, sir, that I haven't felt like this since the time I made my very first jury address as a defense counsel. That was 38 years ago. My client should be getting out anytime soon. I hope I can do a bit better today. Mr. Minister, distinguished members of the committee, Professor Hogg, Justice Karakatsanis, of whom I'm so proud, and ladies and gentlemen, as you might imagine, I am extremely honored to be here, and I am deeply moved by the confidence the Prime Minister has shown in me by putting my name forward as a candidate for the Supreme Court of Canada. One need only consider the 2 justices whom my colleague, Justice Karakatsanis, and I have been nominated to replace to realize what a humbling experience this is. Justices Binney and Chiron have served the court and the people of this country with distinction during their tenure on the court. Each has made an enormous contribution to the jurisprudence of this country in all areas of the law. Justices Binney and Chiron are recognized both nationally and internationally for their legal scholarship, their dedication to the rule of law, and the clear and well-reasoned judgments they have consistently written. Their shoes will be hard, if not impossible, to fill. I can only say that if Justice Karakatsanis and I are ultimately approved to fill their positions, we will do our utmost to carry on the tradition of excellence that they leave behind as their legacy. You know, as I sit here, I cannot help but think that if someone had told me when I was a high school student in Peterborough, which is where I'm from, that someday I would be appearing before an ad hoc committee charged with reviewing my nomination as a candidate for the Supreme Court of Canada, I would have asked them what they had been smoking. Actually, in those days, smoking wasn't in vogue yet, so I probably would have asked them what they'd been drinking. But the message from this is twofold. First, I consider myself extremely fortunate to be here. Second, it confirms my belief that Canada is the greatest country in the world, a country where today's dream can become tomorrow's reality. And I'm very proud to be a Canadian citizen, and I'm proud to call Canada my home. And indeed it is. As I mentioned, I was born and raised in Peterborough, Ontario. My parents, Irving and Ruth Moldaver, are now deceased, but I feel their presence here with me today. My oldest brother, Joel, continues to reside in Peterborough. Joel is a lawyer. He has practiced real estate and commercial law for over 40 years with honor and distinction. I am very proud of him, as I am my middle brother, Pesach, who lives in Toronto and teaches at the Beth Jacob School. Of special note, prior to becoming a teacher, Pesach obtained his doctorate in French literature in Strasbourg, France. Little does he know it, but if my nomination is approved, he will be spending a lot of time in Ottawa teaching his baby brother French. And that is something that I should perhaps address right now. Je suis désolé de mes compétences limitées en français. Ceci dit, j'ai le plus grand respect pour la langue française, pour la culture canadienne-française, y compris la tradition de droit civil, pour les Québécois et Québécoises, ainsi que pour les autres Canadiens et Canadiennes francophones. Si ma nomination est confirmée, je ferai tout en mon pouvoir dans les années qui viennent pour améliorer ma connaissance en français. I'm sorry that I have limited ability in French. That said, I have the greatest of respect for the French language, the French culture, including the civil law tradition, the Québécois, and other French-speaking Canadians. If my nomination is approved, I will do everything in my power in the years ahead to become more proficient in the French language. Returning to my days in Peterborough, if I may, I came from a modest household, but we were always comfortable and I never wanted for anything. My father was in the scrap metal business. He was a very smart man, but he was forced to leave school at age 14 or 15 to help support his family. University educated or not, common sense and good judgment were his long suits. And it was these qualities that enabled him to succeed in business and life in general. My father loved life, and he had a natural affinity for people from all walks of life. The words which my brothers and I inscribed on his headstone pretty much convey what he was all about. Live each day to the fullest and respect the worth and dignity of every human being. My mother was a homemaker. I do not say that lightly. Raising three boys was no walk in the park. In her spare time, which she somehow managed to find, she engaged heavily in community and charitable causes, including VON, Children's Aid, Home and School, and many, many others. She too was extremely smart, but like my father, she also had to leave school at an early age. My mother doted on her three boys, and much as I hate to admit it on national television, she spoiled each and every one of us. By any measure, to me, she was the most wonderful mother in the world. If she were still here, her joy today would be unbounded. For Mom and Dad, a university education for all three children was a must. My brothers and I were going to get the university education that had eluded them. And so it was that all three of us ended up going to university. The deal was that my father and mother would pay for our room and board, and we were expected to work in the summer to pay for our tuition and books. In my case, I worked for a number of summers on the road gang, fixing and repaving the streets of Peterborough. The work I did was mostly pick and shovel, and it was hard work. On a hot summer day, with the asphalt coming off the truck at 700 or 800 degrees Fahrenheit, I can assure you it was no picnic. But it had its redeeming features. First, it was a character builder. If you could get through the summer, you could pretty much get through anything. Second, it exposed me to co-workers from various walks of life, some of whom did not take kindly to university students. To them, we were elitist interlopers, and we had to learn to cope, and we had to learn to get along. And as I've told innumerable law students over the years whom I've had the privilege of teaching, I learned more about talking to juries from my summers on the road gang than I did in all the years I spent in law school. The third bonus from working on the road gang was that it enabled me to include in my CV that I was a Rhodes Scholar. R-O-A-D-S. That paved my way into many gatherings where I met a lot of people far smarter than me. And on occasions, someone would approach me and say, "You know, you spelled Rhodes wrong." To which I would reply, "No, that's the way we spell it in Peterborough." A final note on my family, and then I'll move on. I have two wonderful daughters. Shannon is a lawyer with the Law Society of Upper Canada. She is married to Daniel Dorenbush, and she and Daniel have two beautiful sons, Ethan and Jackson. My younger daughter, Jessica, is completing her fourth year undergraduate program at Dalhousie University in Halifax. She too has expressed an interest in law, but she finds the prospect of the LSAT to be quite daunting. I don't blame her. I think I would have ended up in my father's scrap metal business if I'd had to write it. But needless to say, I'm very proud of both my children. As for my education, I graduated from the University of Toronto with a general arts degree in 1968. I had a modest B average, but that was sufficient in those days to get me into the University of Toronto Law School. Today, I doubt there is a law school in the country that would even look at me with those marks. My law school beginnings were anything but propitious. We had to write a set of exams at Christmas. Fortunately, they didn't count at the end of the year. My marks were less than stellar. Happily, my ending at law school some 3 years later turned out to be a little bit better. After law school, I had the great good fortune of spending the last 6 months of my articling year with Mr. G. Arthur Martin, hands down the greatest criminal lawyer this country has ever produced. That was 1972. As some of you may know, a year later or so, Mr. Martin was appointed to the Ontario Court of Appeal, where he served with great distinction and honor. During his tenure on the court, he was revered by all who had the privilege of appearing before him. I know I was one of his regulars. Prior to articling with Mr. Martin, I had planned to return to Peterborough and practice with my brother Joel, which would have been just fine. But Mr. Martin's influence was too great, and I decided to remain in Toronto and practice criminal law, which is precisely what I did for the next 17 years of my life. During those years, I had the great good fortune of partnering with four of the best criminal lawyers in the province, if not the country: Eddie Greenspan, Brian Greenspan, Alan Gold, and Mark Rosenberg, now Mr. Justice Rosenberg, my colleague on the Ontario Court of Appeal. Over the course of my 17 years as a defense counsel, I came to appreciate the value of a strong, vibrant, independent defense bar and the essential role it played in preserving and protecting the rights of persons charged with criminal offenses. In a speech to the criminal lawyers in the late 80s, I described the role of the Criminal Defense Council as, quotes, vital to the maintenance and preservation of a free and democratic society, end quote. That was my view then, and that is my view now. My life as a defense counsel came to an end in April 1990 when I was appointed to the High Court of Justice as a trial judge. Needless to say, I was very happy, in part because I believed my new job would be something akin to semi-retirement. But boy, did I get a wrong number. From the day I was sworn in until the day I was appointed to the Court of Appeal, some 5.5 years later, I never worked harder in my life. My work consisted mostly of murder trials or sitting in the divisional court with two other judges, hearing judicial review applications from administrative tribunals. And during my 5.5 years on the trial court, I quickly came to realize that trial judges are the unsung heroes of our justice system. They are its backbone. They are the men and women in the front lines. Appellate judges have the luxury of sitting back and watching the battlefield from on high. Trial judges, on the other hand, are in the trenches every day, engaging in one battle after another on a constant and persistent basis. I think we owe our trial judges a great debt of gratitude. Appellate judges in particular can express their gratitude by setting out the law where possible in clear and succinct terms, and by giving trial judges the guidance they need to complete a trial from start to finish without falling into reversible error. My term as a trial judge came to an end in December 1995 when I was appointed to the Ontario Court of Appeal. As an appellate judge, it was no longer my responsibility to determine the facts, nor was it my function to instruct juries on the law. My task, in conjunction with two colleagues, was to review the trial record to determine whether any serious errors of law had been made, and more generally, whether the losing party had received a fair trial. And that, in essence, honourable members, is what I've been doing with my life for the past 15 years. And the good part is I've been doing it with the finest colleagues I could ever have imagined. At present, commencing with Chief Justice Warren Winkler and Associate Chief Justice Dennis O'Connor, and going all the way down the line, I can say without hesitation that I have never worked with a more collegial, more generous, or more warm-spirited group of people, nor have I ever worked with a more intelligent group of people. I hold all of my colleagues in high esteem. Any one of them could be sitting where I am right now. In my years on the court as a whole has worked tirelessly to bring the highest quality of justice to the province of Ontario. Personally, in carrying out my responsibilities, I have been privileged to sit on a number of cases that have been of interest not only to the people of Ontario, but to the country as a whole. Stephen Truscott, the Stephen Truscott reference, the Romeo Filion reference, and the recent grouping of cases involving terrorism are but a few that come to mind. In sum, my experience on the Ontario Court of Appeal has been a positive one from beginning to end, and I am deeply grateful to my colleagues and the exceptional Court of Appeal staff at Osgoode Hall for making it so. In the time I have remaining to you, Mr. Chairman, I want to make a few brief comments about our justice system and the role that judges are called upon to perform in a constitutional democracy. Let me begin by saying that, in my view, Canada has one of the finest justice systems in the whole world. In many respects, it serves as a model for constitutional democracies throughout the world, wherever they exist and wherever they may take root. In general, some of the hallmarks of our justice system include a justice system that is premised on the supremacy of the rule of law, a justice system that prides itself on an independent judiciary and open courtrooms, and a justice system that is founded on the belief that we are all equal before and under the law, and that every human being is entitled to be treated with dignity and respect. Particular to our criminal justice system, I would add the following hallmarks. A justice system that is served by police officers of integrity, who are sworn to uphold the law and who dedicate their lives, often at great personal risk, to ensure that ordinary Canadians like me are able to live out our lives in peace and harmony and safety. A justice system that relies on firm but fair-minded Crown attorneys to protect the interests of society, And finally, a justice system that relies on a strong, vibrant, independent defense bar to protect the interests of persons who are charged and to ensure that they are treated fairly and that they receive a fair trial. And I think everyone would agree it can't get much better than that. The Charter of Rights and Freedoms is an integral part of our Constitution. It constitutes the supreme law of the land, and it serves as a cornerstone of our justice system. In short, it speaks to what we are all about as Canadians and what we aspire to be. Since the advent of the Charter in 1982, judges have been given the authority to strike down laws enacted by Parliament, provincial legislatures, and other government bodies to the extent that the laws in question fail to conform to the provisions of the Charter. That power is an awesome one, and it places a tremendous responsibility on judges to act responsibly. We are not above the law. On the contrary, like the executive and legislative branches of government, we too are bound by the law. Under the rule of law, it is not our function to create laws, nor do we have the right to direct governments on matters of policy. Under the Constitution, we have been given the authority to determine the legality of laws passed by Parliament and the legislatures. In fulfilling that role, we must never lose sight of the fact that we are being asked to strike down laws that have been enacted by a democratically elected majority of parliamentarians. The need for caution and restraint in these circumstances is self-evident. But the ramifications of our decisions must never prevent us from acting fearlessly in accordance with the mandate we have been given. That is our sworn duty, and we must abide by it. Let me end this presentation where I began. I consider it a great honour to have been nominated as a candidate for the Supreme Court of Canada. C'est un très grand honneur pour moi d'avoir été nommé pour siéger à la Cour suprême du Canada. If my nomination is approved, I promise that I will serve the people of Canada to the best of my ability with dedication and integrity. Si ma nomination est approuvée, je m'engage à servir la population de Canada avec diligence et intégrité au mieux de ma compétence. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much, Your Honour. And now, Madam Justice Karakatsanis, please.
Thank you. Mr. Minister, j'ai beaucoup apprécié votre introduction généreuse. Minister, members of the committee, Professor Hogg, Justice Moldaver, ladies and gentlemen. Je suis vraiment ravie d'être candidate pour le poste de juge à la Cour suprême du Canada. I am at once honored and humbled by the confidence that the selection committee has shown in me by including me on its shortlist, and the Prime Minister has shown in nominating me for the extraordinary privilege to serve the public as a judge of the Supreme Court of Canada. I am particularly pleased to be here with my friend and colleague, Justice Moldaver, and as he has said so eloquently, it's very humbling to be nominated to fill the vacancies of two outstanding jurists, Justice Louis Charron and Justice Ian Binney. I would not be entirely honest if I did not admit to some considerable nervousness about this hearing. However, while it may be somewhat nerve-wracking for the nominee, this hearing provides some transparency to the process, and it is a real opportunity for elected officials and the Canadian public to meet the nominees for these important positions. Bien sûr, le processus a été adapté afin de respecter l'indépendance et l'intimité des juges et afin de respecter les contraintes auxquelles les juges sont soumis dans leur discours public, surtout au sujet susceptible d'être abordé à la Cour. Il est très important qu'une juge soit impartiale et qu'elle ait une attitude ouverte. Cette audience publique aujourd'hui me donne donc l'occasion de me présenter aux Canadiens et aux Canadiennes. So in my opening statement, I would like to tell you a little bit about myself, about my background, my family, and my somewhat unusual career as a lawyer in public service. And I will conclude by making some observations about the role of the judiciary and the rule of law in our Canadian democracy. I was born in Toronto to Greek immigrants. Like so many other Canadians, my parents saw Canada as a land of opportunity, and they chose to make it their home. They left their homes in Greece after the Second World War to make a fresh start. They came without language or family or fortune, but with determination and courage, and with the dream of a better future for their children. They came as single young adults. They met here and married, and they built a successful business. Yes, it was a restaurant business. My parents always put their children first and encouraged us to reach for our dreams. They modeled responsibility, generosity, and an extremely strong work ethic. They have been an inspiration and an example. They are watching these proceedings today. They are very proud of me, and I am very proud of them. My husband, Tom Karvanis, has been my life partner for 35 years. We met at the University of Toronto. We went to Osgoode Hall Law School together. And for a few years, we even practiced law together. He has inspired me, he has encouraged me, and he has supported me every step of my career. My children, Paul Karvanis and Rhea Karvanis, have both chosen to start their careers with the law. Paul is an associate with the law firm of Stikeman Elliott in Toronto, and Rhea is in her final year at the U of T Law School. My kids keep me grounded. They regularly remind me that there is no Madam Justice at home. You know, the fact that my children chose to pursue a career with the law, I call that a compliment to their parents. My husband says it's genetic, but my kids, well, they say it's conditioning. I am very proud of my children. My family is just thrilled with my nomination, and they are glued to their television sets this afternoon. You know, Canadian immigrants so often seem able to bring the very best of their cultures with them to Canada. My own parents raised me to love both their adopted country and the best of Greek culture. And yes, in the best of Greek traditions, I have a large extended family, and it's thanks to them that I am adept at cooking for 35 people. My Greek heritage is very much a part of who I am and what I have been able to accomplish. I have always felt grateful to be able to draw on the strengths of different cultures. And my immigrant heritage has also been important to me in my professional life. I believe that it has made me more sensitive to the challenges that immigrants face and more receptive to different cultures. No doubt there were some challenges growing up. I did not speak any English when I first went to kindergarten. I was always aware of certain differences. My parents were stricter than most. And of course, there's my name, Andromache Karakatsanis. I still hear very interesting pronunciations, and I have to spell it out regularly, although today it's been pronounced perfectly. Canada is a country that turns differences into strengths. Having a second language made it easier to learn a third. La langue française a enrichi ma vie personnelle et professionnelle. Comme juge, j'ai profité des programmes de formation linguistique offerts par le commissariat à la magistrature fédérale. Je suis très chanceuse non seulement d'avoir eu l'occasion d'apprendre le français, mais aussi d'avoir pu me familiariser et d'avoir pu vivre l'expérience de la culture québécoise. Chaque année, depuis les huit dernières années, j'ai passé au moins deux semaines dans la province de Québec, deux semaines par année dans la province de Québec, pour suivre les cours d'immersion dans la langue, dans la langue de Molière et parfois dans la langue de la Roue. Il y a maintenant deux ans que j'ai passé l'examen de compétences orales et j'ai obtenu le niveau C. C'est le niveau exigé par le gouvernement fédéral pour les postes désignés bilingues dans la fonction publique. Et à la cour d'appel, j'ai eu l'occasion d'entendre un ou deux appels en français. En septembre dernier, j'ai passé deux semaines à Québec pour suivre un cours de perfectionnement. Je ne suis pas parfaitement bilingue, mais je vais poursuivre mon apprentissage et je vais continuer à améliorer mon français. Je suis très contente d'être en mesure de lire des documents écrits en français, de comprendre les argumentations orales et de discuter de certains enjeux avec mes collègues juristes. Je suis toujours heureuse de discuter avec mes collègues francophones en français. You won't be surprised to hear that my first job was in the family restaurant during school years. It's a great teaching ground for learning to work hard and to work cooperatively. And I learned how to be polite and civil, even when customers were not at their very best. I often advise young people to get experience at working in the service industry. But for me too, university was never a choice, and it wasn't a choice for my sister Catherine or my brother Anthony either. It was a given. My parents just expected us all to become professionals, although I think they left the choice up to us. I could not have chosen better. A career in the law can open up so many interesting and unusual doors in both private and public law. It provides a real opportunity to make a difference. For me, it's been a wonderful and perhaps unconventional journey, for the most part, in public service. For a few years, I practiced law as a partner in a small law firm, litigation, mainly criminal. I then became vice chair and then chair and CEO of the Liquor License Board of Ontario, serving as a tribunal chair and adjudicator in the administrative justice system. Subsequently, when I became secretary of the Ontario Native Affairs Secretariat, I was responsible for the land claim negotiations and Aboriginal policy development. As the Deputy Attorney General of Ontario in the late 1990s, I oversaw court administration and justice services and was responsible for the more than 1,000 lawyers who provided legal advice and support for the Government of Ontario. And finally, I was appointed Secretary of Cabinet and Clerk of the Executive Council. And as the most senior public servant in Ontario, I was responsible for the oversight of the integrity of the cabinet decision-making process and for providing professional public administration. My experience as a senior public servant has given me a broad understanding of how government works and a broad perspective on social and legal issues. I take great pride in my career as a nonpartisan professional public servant. I was first appointed by Premier Peterson as Chair and CEO of the Liquor License Board. I was reappointed by Premier Ray, and I was appointed a Deputy Minister and then Head of the Public Service by Premier Harris. I'm proud of having received Premier appointments from the leaders of three different political parties. During my 15 years with the Ontario Public Service, I served directly with 13 ministers and four premiers. I have enormous respect for the work of elected officials, and I believe deeply in our system of parliamentary democracy with the three pillars of the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. Of course, I am most privileged to have had the opportunity to continue public service as a judge for almost 9 years. It'll be 9 years next month. I was a trial judge for 7.5 years. And the diversity of the people who appear in our courtrooms, the range of human experiences, and the variety of factual and legal issues means that a judge's work is often exhausting, but it's rarely boring. As a trial judge, I learned how important it is to listen, to keep an open mind, and not to rush to judgment. The cases often turned out quite differently than I might have anticipated. And I learned the need for humility and civility if you must stand in judgment of others. A judge must always be intellectually honest and is bound by the evidence and the law. Indeed, judges are subject to real constraints. They must conduct court proceedings in accordance with well-established rules of procedural fairness. They must follow precedent and apply the interpretation developed by the jurisprudence. Je vais toujours respecter le travail du juge de procès, un travail si important et si stimulant. Néanmoins, j'adore le travail de juge d'appel. J'ai une passion pour la loi, j'aime écrire et j'aime travailler avec les autres. I have served on the Court of Appeal for the last year and a half. It has been an intense and rewarding experience. I have loved every minute of working with the incredibly smart, accomplished, and collegial judges of the Court of Appeal for Ontario. They welcomed me so warmly, and without exception, they are extraordinary jurists. If my nomination proceeds, I will miss them all very, very much. As Justice Moldaver has said, Parliament has given judges the awesome responsibility to ensure that government acts in accordance with the Canadian Charter of Human Rights and Freedoms. But we do so with respect, recognizing that it is the responsibility of elected officials to make the difficult public policy decisions and to make the difficult decisions about how to spend public funds. Of course, if the law violates the Charter, it must be struck down. This is the role that Parliament has given to the judiciary. Le Canada est un pays bilingue et bijuridique, et par conséquent, c'est un pays plus fort. Le Canada est un pays possédant deux systèmes de droit et deux langues officielles. Bien entendu, je n'ai pas fait mes études universitaires en droit civil. Cependant, il est important pour moi de comprendre le Code civil ainsi que l'approche et les principes du droit civil. Si je deviens juge à la Cour suprême du Canada, je vais travailler avec diligence pour apprendre le Code civil en lisant le plus possible et en discutant avec mon collègue à la magistrature. D'ailleurs, pour moi, c'est une des joies d'occuper les fonctions de juge, de pouvoir apprendre tous les jours de ma vie. I have been privileged to view the justice system from several very different and broad perspectives. As I reflect back on 3 decades of a diverse legal career, one thing stands out. The rule of law is the cornerstone of our free and democratic society and as our way of life as Canadians. The rule of law means that no one is above the law. The rule of law allows us to live together in freedom and in harmony. We often take it for granted, but I believe it is what makes Canada the envy of the world. The rule of law is a reality because of our justice system, and at the heart of the justice system is the public's confidence in the independence and the integrity of the judiciary. Judges have a tremendous responsibility to apply the law impartially and with an open mind and fearlessly in accordance with the law and precedent. We must embody and protect the fundamental values of our Canadian community in accordance with our Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. We must bring independence of thought with humility of spirit, recognizing that the rule of law must be safeguarded for all. As a passionate Canadian, I would be proud to serve this country as a member of its highest court. Je crois que le Canada est le meilleur pays du monde. C'est un pays qui nous permet de célébrer à la fois nos différences ainsi que nos valeurs canadiennes. C'est un pays qui accueille la diversité. Canada is a land of opportunity and of generosity. It's a land of astonishing beauty and diversity. C'est un pays fort et libre. I am honored to be here today. I would be thrilled to have the opportunity for such important and challenging work with the talented and dedicated judges on the Supreme Court of Canada. Ça sera un privilège et un plaisir de travailler avec les juges de la plus haute cour du Canada. I solemnly promise that if appointed to the Supreme Court of Canada, I will discharge this public trust to the very best of my abilities. I'm ready to take questions.
Can we go now, Mr.
Chair? We wish. Well, thank you very much. And as agreed between the members of the committee, we're going to we'll go through the speaking rotation now. And I would call upon my colleague Candace Heppner to begin the questioning.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I want to begin by saying how honoured I am to be able to welcome both Madam Justice Karakatsanis and Mr. Justice Moldaver here today. I want to tell you how honoured I am to meet you. I was part of the five-member selection panel that did provide the shortlist, and I've never had the opportunity to meet you before. And so having spent some time looking at your qualifications together with my very esteemed colleagues, who we worked very well together, and it was a pleasure to work with each one of my colleagues, but together we looked at your qualifications, we looked at different areas surrounding the work that you've done. And so today it's just a real honor and a privilege to meet you. And I want to assure you both that when we looked at your qualifications, when we looked at your character, and when we looked at your record of excellence, we all agreed unanimously that you would make excellent Supreme Court justices. So thank you so much for accepting the nominations and for being here and being willing to be part of this process. What's so good, I believe, about the process today is that Canadians can watch and can listen to you. And after hearing both of your presentations, I'm also very impressed and proud of your humanity and your humility and the genuine humility that you are bringing to this, and the value for family, the value for the experiences that you've had, for hard work. And there are a lot of Canadians watching today who probably have never had a need to even to meet a lawyer, unless maybe they've done a real estate transaction, and probably never a judge, and probably not someone who's being nominated for the Supreme Court of Canada. And so I'm posing my question today actually from a Canadian who I met over the weekend. We had no idea that this session would be happening today, but the question was posed in terms of accountability for judges in Canada. And I think it was probably posed in the context of, we know that American judges are elected, and so for some Canadians that raises the question of accountability. And I'm wondering if both of you, if you both could address this and maybe explain it to our committee, to Canadians, how our system works in terms of how you are accountable and to whom you are accountable, and if you would draw on your experience as judges, both trial judges and appeal court judges. Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Actually, judges are accountable in a number of different ways. It starts first with our principle of an open courtroom. We do our work in the public, it's open to public scrutiny, and we welcome, certainly as a trial judge, I frequently had members of the public, often school children as well, in my courtroom. And so that is a very important principle that underlies the accountability of judges. We have to give reasons for our decision. Those reasons have to be clear, and must explain why we have reached a certain result. That's another form of accountability. Those reasons are reviewed sometimes by the Court of Appeal. That's yet another level of accountability for judicial decision-making. On the personal front, being a judge means that you have to be very aware always that you hold a very important public position and that you must act with integrity in your personal as well as professional life. And there is a process, Canadians do avail themselves of it, and they can lodge complaints with the Canadian Judicial Council, who will review any complaints about conduct. That is a process that is there to assure that we are able to carry out our jobs, our profession, in a way that maintains the public's confidence in the administration of justice. I have to say, as a judge, I feel that there's just so many different ways in which I have to be careful. I'm always cautious about what I say and how I say it. I'm careful when I'm enjoying myself in public, in a restaurant or at a party. It's just, I'm always conscious that it's not just me, but that I fill a position. It's an important public position, and the public must trust the people who have those positions. I think there's a fair bit of accountability.
May I just add to that briefly, if I may? And I agree with everything my colleague has said, and she said it, as she always does, very eloquently. I believe we are here to serve the people. The people are not here to serve us. I find it somewhat ironic that when people come into the courtroom, they nod their heads or bow to us. We should be bowing to the people. They are our constituency. And I think we have an obligation to the people to do our very best to write judgments that are intelligible and that the people can understand. I think we have a very great responsibility to those, for example, who are in law enforcement, who are day in, day out, having to make difficult decisions in trying situations, that again, we try our best to make the law clear so that they can understand what it is they can and cannot do. The laws have to be, as I say, understandable to the people who are involved with them. And what I mean by that is this: people have a right to know what they can and cannot do. And that, with respect, is your responsibility, but it's our responsibility as well. And I think to that extent, that is probably the most important aspect of accountability that I would consider in terms of response to your very important question. Thank you so much for it.
Can I just add one thing?
Yes, please.
I mean, so often when people think of judges, they think of people who have authority and power. I have to tell you, sitting in our chairs, it's just about our responsibility. That's what it feels like. We have this awesome responsibility.
I'll go to the New Democrat Party, and I look, of course, to the new House Leader of the New Democrat Party for...
He's just saying that in a pleasant way because he's happy to get rid of me as his justice critic. another time. Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, I woke up, Mr. Justice Moldaver, at about 3:30 this morning, considering how I was going to cross-examine you today. And it's not easy, but I'm sure you're aware that it's your appointment that has the controversy around it because of your lack of capability in the French language. And I just want to be clear on this. If from your opening comments, je comprends que vous pouvez pas parler français du tout. Je vais répéter en français. Je comprends que vous pouvez, and I'll say it in English. I understand that you're not able to speak French at all. The statements that you read today, I assume, had been prepared, and you were reading those statements.
That's correct, sir.
Yes. Mr. Justice Moldaver, I mean, it's really interesting. We see the comparison here between the two candidates. Was there any advantage that Madam Justice Karakatsanis had in terms of learning French that was not available to you?
No, sir, there wasn't.
And with regard, I just want to go back to the controversy. We've had editorials in the some of the newspapers in Quebec. We've had the Barreau du Québec pressing the government to reconsider your nomination. We've certainly have had the Commissioner of Official Languages, who's been very clear over a number of years now that it is an absolute requirement. It's one of the qualities. We listened to Professor Hogg as to what the qualities are of a judge. According to the Commissioner of Official Languages, one of those qualities is the ability to be able to work in French and in English when you're sitting on the highest court of this country. What do you say to people like that? And let me share with you, what do my colleagues from the province of Quebec, all of the, my colleagues from the province of Quebec, say to their constituents as to why a member, and Mr. Moldaver, I want to be very clear here, I've followed your career for a long time. You know, we have personal friends, each other. Not you and I, but we both have friends to each other. I followed your career. I have no questions about your ability, except for that one, for me, crucial element. So what do we say? What do you say to the province of Quebec, to the Francophonie communities across the country?
Well, thank you, Mr. Cromartin. That's a very, very important question, and I take it very seriously, I assure you. My lack of fluency at the present time in French will clearly make my task that much harder on the court. But I'm not even so much worried about me. I feel that, and I understand exactly the concern, certainly from counsel who appear before the court and who wish to speak in the French language and who understandably would want a judge that can engage with them in the French language, which I readily admit at this time I cannot do. That said, I can only commit to you that I will be taking up, obviously, I will be studying and I'll be learning and I'll be meeting with someone, obviously, to learn French as quickly as I can. There is simultaneous translation, which obviously will be of assistance to me. I will have available law clerks who can assist me in understanding factums and so on that are filed in French. I will have, obviously, colleagues who can assist me. And all I can say, sir, is that I'll do everything I can in my power to get as proficient as I can in the French language as quickly as possible. I respect the question. I respect very much the views of the Quebecois. I am what I am. I will just do everything I can, as I said in my opening, to try and get as proficient as I can as quickly as possible. I can't do more than that, sir.
Justin Moldaver, I have to say this to you. I was the only one who sat through. I'm sorry, Mr. Kotler may have sat through it as well. One of the only two on this committee who sat through the appointment review of Mr. Justice Rothstein. I don't know, maybe it's, you know, once burned, twice shy, but I heard the same commitment from him. And we all know that was five and a half years ago, and Mr. Justice Rothstein is still not able to conduct any hearings in French. I just make that as a comment. I don't want a response. Let me go on. For the sake of the public who's listening, when you were first approached by the Justice Department to have let your name be placed forward, was there any discussion from the Justice Department of your lack of ability to speak in French?
Well, I certainly made it clear right at the outset that I was not bilingual, so that was known, yes, sir.
Okay. And can I ask you this? Do you know who else was on either the long list or the short list of the final six names that were presented to the Minister of Justice and the Prime Minister, either the short list or the long list? Do you know anybody, obviously, other than your companion today sitting at the table with you? In terms of the other names, anybody else do you know who is on those lists?
I have heard rumors, but I tell you sincerely, we were kept in the dark. We were completely kept in the dark.
Would you agree with me that there are other members of the Ontario Court of Appeal with a similar strong background in criminal law who are also bilingual?
No, I wouldn't agree with that, sir.
Okay.
If you're just talking background in criminal law, there's some other very, very highly qualified members of our court who are excellent in all areas of the law. I'm not going to try and mislead anybody. But if you're asking about the members of our court who have criminal law background, the simple answer is no. None of us are bilingual.
How many judges sit on the Court of Appeal of Ontario?
About 22, I think.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell me of that panel how many are able to conduct trials in French?
How many could do a trial?
I'm sorry, an appeal in French.
I think there's about five or so.
Madam Justice,
Justice Karakatsanis.
I think there are five on the that were called upon, including myself.
Okay.
Martin, there will be a second round, of course, and. Colleagues, there's just to let you know, there is an unscheduled vote in another. Oh, I'm thinking about another 15 minutes. 20 minutes. Oh, that's even better. My proposal is that we get through another one, possibly two, and then we'll have a break. We were going to have a break anyway, and I guess we don't have much choice at this point in time. Mr. Decker, go ahead.
Thank you, Minister, and Justice Karakatsanis and Moldaver. I just want to say it's a great honor for me to meet you both and to have been a part of this process, both as a lawyer and as a member of Parliament. Here we are, two of the pillars of our democracy, which is so important, and I think it's just a really wonderful and important and historic day for Canada that you're here to address all Canadians, and I was really honored to be a part of the selection process, and to note that in that process the list that we submitted to the Minister of Justice and to the Prime Minister was arrived at by consensus by all the members on that committee, and it was a very collegial process, as I know your work is on the Court of Appeal. Having said that, I'd like to start, if I could, with Justice Moldaver. Justice Moldaver, I am very well aware of your long history as a very eminent counsel before you were appointed to the bench, and you mentioned it in your opening remarks. And I wonder if you could, I noted that from your resume that you practice both as a sole practitioner, as a boutique at a boutique specialty firm, and also at a very large and general law firm.
That's right.
And I wonder if you could comment for us how your experience, your long experience as a member of the practicing bar, prepared you for life on the bench, life on the Court of Appeal, and eventually for service as a member of the Supreme Court of Canada. And I wonder if you could give us a sense of how the practice of law may have changed in the years since you were practicing as eminent counsel, and also what advice you might have for members of the practicing bar, both appearing before trial division or at the Court of Appeal or ultimately Supreme Court of Canada.
Well, thank you very much for that question. My years of practice taught me that what had caused me to go into criminal law to a certain extent to begin with was really not quite accurate. I was a great fan, and so was everybody in my household, of Perry Mason. And I had this impression that if I went into criminal law, it would be wonderful to engage in cross-examinations in the courtroom and have witnesses faint and confess and so on. And of course, that really never quite happened. In fact, the harder they were pressed, the more they stood their ground. And I quickly realized that the courtroom was not a fun place. Tell it just the way it was, the great bulk of my practice was spent trying to just help people. It wasn't going to court, it wasn't having a trial, it was just trying to help people who had run afoul of the criminal law, who had various problems, whether they be drug problems or gambling problems or alcohol problems or whatever they may be, and take as much time as you could with them prior to actually them pleading guilty, perhaps of the crime that they were charged, perhaps of some lesser crime, but trying to get them into a position, trying to deal with the problems that they had that caused them to become involved in the criminal law to begin with, in the hopes that after this was all over, they would be either fully or at least partially on the road to rehabilitation, and that they would become decent, responsible members of society. So many people used to sort of say to me, and in fact, students that I would talk to about this would say, your role is more like a social worker. And I said, well, that may be, but that's just fine, because I'm here to help people. And if helping people means getting them help and just not going to trial and not taking frivolous trials when they are clearly guilty, then that's the way I'm going to approach my task. Now, sometimes you had to go to trial. And when you went to trial, speaking for myself, I lost a piece of myself every time. Whether I ended up winning, well, I didn't end up winning. I guess I ended up winning or not. I guess the better thing is whether my clients ended up winning or losing. And when I would lose a client to the Kingston Penitentiary for life, it hurt. And it hurt for a long time. You win a case and you're on a high for a night and you're on to the next one. You lose a case, and I wouldn't let you see it if I was walking on the street and met any of you, but my tummy would be hurting for a long time, and I would be second-guessing myself and thinking, what could I have done, what should I have done, what didn't I do, and as I drew up the papers for the appeal, hoping that somehow I could rectify the situation. Now, part of that was I practiced law in a way that I didn't really want to go to trial on any sort of a serious case unless I believed or at least had a reasonable doubt in the innocence of my client. And that is not the traditional view, but that is the way I practiced, because if I didn't have that belief in my client, I could not speak properly to juries. I could not be sincere. I could not, my voice would change if I was arguing something that I really didn't believe in. Well, that caused greater pain, though, when I lost someone to Kingston. And I guess the point of that is just to say that I think you have to be very discerning in the practice. I think those who enter the practice of law, whether it be criminal law or civil litigation, in the idea that going to the court is some, you know, wonderful experience, it isn't. There's no certainty in the courtroom. There's absolutely no certainty in the courtroom. You can prepare to the nth degree and still lose. And I can tell you, if anybody were ever interested in detail about my losses, and I forgot a lot about my wins. So that was it. There's a very human side to the practice. I'm sorry if I'm going on too long. I'm just not quite sure where you'd like me to go. I sort of, if you could just tell me the third part.
Maybe if you have any advice for counsel practicing today, right, both at the trial level and, now, and perhaps before the Supreme Court.
Well, I think that's a very important question. And I know that there have been things that I have said that have been, in my respectful view, taken the wrong way. I'm looking and have always been held in the highest regard, good, competent advocates. I mean, they're the backbone of our trial system, from the defense bar, from the Crown's point of view. The simple truth is, if you have a good Crown and a good defense counsel, you'll resolve 98% of the cases. That's the truth of it. Mm-hmm. And so I just say to counsel, be responsible. Bring charter applications. Absolutely bring them. But take a hard look before you do. Remember that we have a justice system that is in many respects overburdened with long and complex cases, and the good counsel, the really good counsel, the counsel that I respect enormously, they don't waste the court's time. They pick their spots. They pick their spots. They choose their charter motions and so on, and they make a compelling argument, or at least an arguable case, and win or lose, no judge could question the propriety of their conduct. I think I'm done, but
thank
I'm
you,
sorry,
Your Honor.
We could go on for a while.
Appreciate that very much. We're right on
thank
time.
You.
And, to one of my predecessors as Minister of Justice and a veteran of this process, Erwin Kotler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The issue of bilingualism has been raised by my colleague. I happen to be a Quebecer, and as you know, the Quebec Bar has made the statement to the effect that citizens and counsel appearing before the court should not only have the right, which they do, to plead in either of the two official languages, but to be expected to be understood in either of the two official languages. And so I just want to close on this point, because I think you've already responded by saying, as far as I can appreciate it, you are not the first unilingual judge to be appointed to the Supreme Court, and I would hope that you will follow the principle and precedent of your colleagues who have become bilingual, and I appreciate the undertaking that you made before us today to do exactly that. I just have a question I'd like to put to the two of you. It wasn't something I was necessarily going to ask, but I have to say I was very moved by the respective discussions by each of you of your backgrounds, of your family background, of your family values, of that which you internalized growing up. And so the question I want to put to each of you is, if you can share with us and the public at large, you know, who have been some of your heroes? Who are some of the legal role models that you have that have been inspired you in your work? What are some of the life experiences that have brought you to where you are today? And I since you've made reference, and rightly and significantly so, to your families, I would ask you to maybe do so at this point without reference to the families when you discuss these inspirational people, role models, and the like.
The first hero for me is one of the great jurist that was already mentioned by Justice Moldaver. Justice Moldaver worked with him in private practice when he was a defense counsel. I clerked for the Ontario Court of Appeal in 1982, and I had the privilege of clerking with G. Arthur Martin. And it was, you know, in those days, he was my hero. We would go once a month to Kingston to do the prisoner appeals, and I was always the law clerk who volunteered to go to Kingston because I got to sit beside Justice Martin on the train on the way to Kingston, and would be able to hear him talk, and just to spend the time with him was extraordinary. But I also did work for him, and he was he could pinpoint a reference on a particular page, in a particular volume, in a particular case. And I've just never met anyone else who's been just so, had such an extraordinary memory and understanding of the criminal law. I worked with Pat Hart on a couple of trials early in my career, and he said to me, there is never, ever any excuse for lack of civility in the courtroom. No matter what the circumstances, by anybody, but especially by a judge. I've worked when I was in government. I worked with Chief Justice McMurtry and Chief Justice Pat Lesage. And in fact, I think it was as a result of their example and inspiration that I thought that what I'd really like to do is be a judge. That tradition has carried on. Chief Justice Winkler has been an amazing role model for me. He was my senior regional justice when I was a trial judge in Toronto. He gave me certain responsibilities, you know, in respect of small claims court, and he let me run with them, and he was always there for advice. He's been an extraordinary Chief Justice, and I am, you know, I've just been really grateful for the opportunity to have such wonderful role models and really legal heroes.
And just to pick up in terms of the bench, I mean, I couldn't agree more. I when I went to the Court of Appeal, it was just when the Honourable Roy McMurtry came on almost at the same time. I think I was there about a month before him. And what a remarkable man, what a remarkable leader he was. I could go on at great length and heap praise on, I still call him my chief, but I won't, there are time constraints. The Honourable John Morton, of course, too, was Associate Chief Justice, and again, just a giant, just an absolute giant in the legal profession. And one of the things that I've noticed, and I'm going to tell you a few names in a moment, but the biggest people that I've met and the ones that I have the most respect for have consistently been the most humble people mm-hmm. that I have met. Justice Karakatsanis mentioned the Honorable G. Arthur Martin. He was the most humble, decent, kind man. I never heard him raise his voice in the Court of Appeal. He knew more criminal law than anybody in the whole room, but he didn't make you feel bad. He would actually teach as he sort of told you where you were wrong, and you always walked out, win, lose, or draw, feeling that you'd had a good hearing and that you had been in the presence of greatness. But to go back to law school, believe it or not, my first mentor in first year law school at U of T, we had mentors who took sort of a group of 8 or 10 people. I was fortunate enough to have someone by the name of David Johnson, His Excellency the Governor General. And he was the nicest man. I was nervous as could be starting law school. You heard me say I didn't do very well the first term. And he was so generous and so kind and so helpful. And he had us over to the house and we met his wife and he had us for dinner. And what a delightful, wonderful man. And look at where he is today. John Willis, I don't know if any of you know John Willis, but he followed on the heels of someone by the name of Marty Friedland, who was teaching me criminal law, and then Marty had to go down for a sabbatical to Australia. John Willis took over, and John Willis could teach anything. He could teach administrative law, he could teach torts. As it happened, he filled in for Marty Friedland, who was a great lecturer in criminal law. But John Willis taught us criminal law by putting one sentence on the board. He put one example on the board. We didn't have to look at a book. We didn't have to look at a case. He took us through the basics of criminal law in one sentence on the blackboard. Just a giant as well. Alan Mewitt taught me evidence. I mean, just a great, great person. Again, someone that could walk into the class virtually without a note and just talk because he knew his subject so well. So those are a few of the people. When I started to practice, of course, I had the great good fortune to practice with Eddie Greenspan, who I don't have to tell you what a wonderful criminal lawyer he is. So perhaps I could leave it at that. I'm going on too long, but I've been really fortunate to have been exposed to some extremely exceptional people. Thank you.
Can I add one more person? Professor Peter Hogg. He taught me in first year, I think it was constitutional, and I took every single course he offered thereafter. Best teacher I ever had.
Can I add one thing to that, too? He appeared in front of us once in the Court of Appeal, and unfortunately he lost, but he was vindicated in the Supreme Court of Canada.
I love it. Colleagues, I'm going to propose that we take a 15-minute break. I apologize to our witnesses. Unfortunately, we've got a vote that the House of Commons we have to go to right now. So we'll adjourn for 15 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
much, colleagues, and sorry for that interruption, but it hopefully gave us a little bit of a break, and so we'll continue, and I'll have the questioning started again by my colleague, Mr. Rathgeber.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to the witnesses, and I join in with my colleagues indicating what a great pleasure it is to meet you both, having read a significant amount of your judgments and published papers in the last couple of months. It's certainly an honor to meet you both in person, and congratulations on being nominated for this esteemed position. And a very simple question for you, my lord. During Madam Justice's opening comments, she spoke partially in French. And I noticed you had an earpiece in your ear. Did you have any difficulty understanding or following the flow of her opening statement?
I'm looking at the translators. It was very clear. So I commend the translators because I thought they were doing a marvelous job.
Right. And I agree. And you were no doubt aware that the Supreme Court of Canada offers the high caliber quality of simultaneous translation that we enjoy here at the House of Commons. You know.
Yes,
that.
Yes, sir, I am.
Thank you. Yeah. I want to change directions. I want to talk a little bit to both of you about the phenomenon of television cameras in the courtrooms. And Madam Justice, you talked about open courtrooms and that being part of the whole issue of accountability. And in the United States, we've seen quite an evolution in the last couple decades regarding television cameras in the courtrooms. And they have their detractors and they have their proponents. And the advocates, I guess, argue that it leads to openness and transparency and perhaps demystifies the process. But the critics, and I think I fall into that category, would argue that it occasionally turns lawyers and sometimes judges into media stars and occasionally turns the process into a bit of a spectacle, maybe even a sideshow in the States when there's cameras. So I have two questions for each of you, and perhaps we'll start with Madam Justice. You've both been trial and appellate court justices where there are no TV cameras. You will presumably and possibly be becoming justices where they do have cameras in the Supreme Court of Canada. So the first question is, what are your thoughts on becoming a TV judge? And secondly, and what are your thoughts more generally on, there has been some consideration of allowing cameras into the trial courts, and you have both been trial court judges, and I would like to hear, I'd be interested in hearing your comments on that. So we'll start with you, Madam Justice.
You know, this is a subject that I haven't given a great deal of thought to. I must say that I would have absolutely no difficulty with having cameras in the Supreme Court of Canada. It makes a lot of sense to me that the public have a chance to see how the court works and hear the arguments of counsel. And I think this the issue is much more difficult when it comes to trial courts. When I was chair of the Liquor License Board, we had actually, at that time, decided we'd let the cameras in, actually much like it happened today, at the beginning of the hearing. But once a witness started to testify, the cameras were no longer rolling. As a trial court judge, I know there are policies. I've forgotten precisely what they are, but certainly no cameras during the hearings themselves. You know, like so many things, there are arguments that to be considered in favor of more openness, more transparency, opening it up to even greater audiences, allowing Canadians to see how trials work. I think that would be a very positive thing. On the other side, you have to worry about whether there's a potential for any negative impact on the way the trials themselves proceed. And I'm thinking particularly of, you know, how witnesses may feel about being televised. And of course, there's also some issues that in certain kinds of cases, there would be some privacy implications as well. So it's a great question. I can't give you a great answer. I haven't thought about it enough.
You're going to reserve judgment.
I'm going to reserve judgment. Thank you.
Mr. Justice Moldaver?
Well, thank you. It is a great question. And I have no difficulty whatsoever with cameras in the appellate courts, if that is what people want. It's a very different forum than the trial court, as we all know. The only experience that I've ever had with cameras in the courtroom at the appellate level was the Stephen Truscott reference. And you know, for about a minute and a half, we noticed them and so on. And then, of course, once you're into the argument and the debate, I mean, it's as if they're not even there. And I can say without hesitation that I don't think it impacted whatsoever on the way I or any of my colleagues conducted ourselves. As I say, it was as if they weren't there. Now, having said that, if you decide to put cameras in the appellate courts, I'm not sure how broad the audience would be, but that's a different matter. Trial courts, in my view, are a very different thing. The stresses and pressures, and it can be a very nerve-wracking experience for witnesses. It can be a dreadful experience for complainants, for example, in sexual assault trials and so on, and talking about the most private things in their life. That's one that, in my view, would have to be very much studied. I would never want to see our trials turn into what we regrettably saw some years ago in the United States in a particular case. And we cannot, in my respectful view, ever allow something like that to happen. So I would go very carefully in terms of the trial courts. But as far as the appellate courts go, I have no concerns.
How much time do I have? I'll defer.
Okay, thank you very much. Madame Boivin.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre. Moi, je fais partie de ceux qui sont tellement accros à la Cour suprême du Canada que je regarde à la télé le dimanche matin. Et je vais vous dire pourquoi. Parce que j'ai eu une expérience absolument extraordinaire. Ça me rajeunit pas, mais en 1985, je plaidais ma première cause à la Cour suprême du Canada. Et j'étais probablement bien innocente, bien naïve, mais je me sentais probablement comment vous vous sentez, vous autres, à passer devant nous cet après-midi. Très nerveuse à me dire est-ce qu'ils vont m'écouter, est-ce qu'ils vont comprendre ce que je dis, et ainsi de suite, ainsi de suite. Et j'ai eu, je dirais, probablement comme quoi la vie nous définit, surtout dans les moments, comment ils se déroulent, si ça va bien ou si ça va pas bien. Et j'ai eu la chance d'avoir un banc de trois juges. C'était pour une permission d'appeler devant la Cour suprême du Canada, toute jeune, fraîchement sortie de l'université. Et j'avais le bonheur total, fait que vous allez me voir venir avec mes grands sabots, d'être devant un banc de trois juges qui comprenait le français. Alors, pour moi, j'ai plaidé dans ma langue, j'ai eu un dialogue, j'ai trouvé l'expérience extraordinaire, puis ils ont eu la gentillesse, compte tenu de mon jeune âge, de le prendre la cause en délibéré. Même s'ils m'ont planté deux jours plus tard, c'est pas grave, j'avais eu mon moment de gloire à la Cour suprême. Alors, tout ceci pour vous dire comment la Cour suprême, pas seulement pour les avocats, mais pour les justiciables aussi, est extrêmement importante. Je veux vous dire tout de suite qu'après avoir lu les deux dossiers qu'on nous a transmis, j'ai pas de raison de croire qu'en termes de juriste, en termes légal, vos backgrounds à tous les deux sont extraordinaires, j'ai aucun doute là-dessus. Par contre, j'ai un problème, monsieur le juge Moldaver, puis je viens du Québec. J'ai pratiqué toute ma vie au Québec comme avocate. J'ai fait du droit criminel, du droit du travail. Je sais comment c'est important pour les gens de se faire comprendre, puis se faire comprendre pas seulement par interprète. D'ailleurs, je me suis astreinte à quelque chose que je fais jamais ici au Parlement. Jamais, parce que je suis parfaitement bilingue. Et je le dis en toute humilité, là, mais parfaitement bilingue. Je me suis branchée sur le canal de traduction. Et je me souviendrai toujours, je me rappelle pas du nom du juge de la Cour d'appel du Québec qui nous avait dit, lorsque vous passez devant nous, et c'est un peu la même chose avec la Cour suprême du Canada, ils ne refont pas le procès. On s'en va là pour les convaincre qu'il y a eu une erreur de droit, de regarder des choses très précises, très techniques. Tout est dans le mot, tout est... Et le juge avait dit, à 80-quelques pourcents, on est pas mal décidé vers où on va pencher. Vous n'aurez pas de surprise. Par contre, on se garde une petite gêne, puis un petit pourcentage, ça va être peut-être que vous allez sortir en plaidoirie quelque chose qui va nous convaincre. Et la force de conviction, je regrette, puis je vous aime beaucoup les traducteurs du Parlement et de la Cour suprême du Canada, vous faites un travail extraordinaire. Mais les farces de M. le juge Moldaver, Il n'était pas drôle de la bouche d'une traductrice. Tout ceci pour vous dire que dans les nuances, ça se manque. Et quand on regarde, vous avez tous les deux parlé de l'importance de la primauté du droit. La règle de droit, moi, j'ai vécu ma vie en me disant, c'est ça qu'on on représente, nous, les avocats, les juges, et ainsi de suite. Et quand j'entends que depuis 1990, Monsieur le juge Moldaver, vous aviez l'opportunité, si vous aviez l'ambition de vous en aller à la Cour suprême du Canada un jour, sachant que vous allez avoir, au moins selon les statistiques qu'on reçoit, le tiers des dossiers qui vont être en français. Puis je ne parle pas juste comme québécoise, parce qu'on a beaucoup de francophones à l'extérieur du Québec aussi, donc de franco-ontariens, franco-manitobains, et ainsi de suite. Alors, ces gens-là, les documents qui vont arriver, d'entendre que vous allez tout simplement vous fier à un clerc, et j'en avais un qui m'a écrit, qui est maintenant un grand constitutionnaliste, d'après moi, Hugo Cyr, qui me disait, lorsqu'il était clair à la Cour suprême pour le juge Bini, l'ensemble du dossier qui arrive n'est pas traduit nécessairement. Alors, ça donne encore plus de poids au travail du clerc, à vos autres collègues de la Cour suprême du Canada. Et à ce niveau-là, je ne suis pas nécessairement convaincue que c'est satisfaisant. En fait, je ne suis pas du tout convaincue que et je le dis en tout respect, ça, c'est la formule qu'on apprenait comme avocat en passant, quand on disait quelque chose de pas très poli, mais au moins, ça avait l'air poli. Mais je ne suis pas convaincue que c'est suffisant pour accéder à la plus haute cour du pays à ce stade-ci. Parce que vous allez devoir vous fier à vos clercs, vous allez devoir... Les gens qui vont aller là n'auront pas, malgré toute la bonne volonté des traducteurs, de vos collègues et ainsi de suite, moi, je ne pense pas que c'est un service qu'on rend à la Cour suprême du Canada. Et si on croit fondamentalement dans le bilinguisme dans ce pays-ci, et moi, j'y crois, ben il faut faire plus que simplement toujours le dire, ou pour citer mon collègue Kotler, sans le mettre sur la sellette, dire, on se l'est déjà fait dire, mon collègue Comartel disait, monsieur le juge est accro, je ne peux pas être plus accro, j'ai même regardé le processus en 2006, puis je n'étais même pas députée à ce moment-là, et je trouvais ça d'une tristesse de voir un juge qui accédait à la magistrature, à la Cour suprême, mais je me disais, on va donner la chance au coureur. Malheureusement, il n'a pas nécessairement accompli sa part de la bargain, pour prendre un mot très français. Alors, je ne sais pas à ce niveau-là comment vous pouvez me rassurer, M. le juge Moldaver, mais avec ce que j'ai dans le dossier concernant le fait qu'il n'y en a pas eu d'effort de 90 à aller jusqu'à maintenant, et je me pose la question, est-ce que vous croyez que les gens qui vont devant la Cour suprême ont le droit d'être entendus dans la langue de leur choix et que les juges devraient comprendre ce dont ils parlent, autant les juristes que ce qu'il y a dans le dossier?
Mr. Justice Moldaver here, we're just about out of time, but on this one. Go ahead.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that question. It's a very important question. I don't doubt that for one moment. And my simple answer to you, Madam Levin, in terms of why I did not further my French, I don't want to be misunderstood here. I actually loved French in high school. I loved it in university, and I really enjoyed the language. And I am looking forward, if my nomination is approved, to taking it up again. I'm hoping I have my brother's genes, who became a doctorate in French literature. I absolutely love the language. I love going when we have conferences, when we used to teach at New Judges School in Quebec, and I love talking to the judges from Quebec and talking a little bit of French here and there. It's a wonderful, wonderful culture, and I'm looking forward to it. Why didn't I do it when I had the opportunity? Quite simply, I never expected to be here. Not in my wildest dreams, never, ever. And if someone had given me a crystal ball when I was in university or whatever and said, you're going to be someday before a committee and have a very important question put to you like the one that you just raised, believe me, I would not have squandered those years. We have wonderful, wonderful training for judges. Mm-hmm. And there were times that I thought I would like to just take it up. And then other things got in the way and so on. But the simple answer is, I never thought I would be here.
Sir, Monsieur Gauguin.
Participating in this historic event, it's indeed a pleasure to meet such learned judiciary. And we all know as lawyers and judges that it's always more fun to ask the questions than it is to answer them. And I noted a while ago, Mr. Justice Moldaver, that you said that the courtroom is not a fun place, and I guess I could start by asking you, are you having fun yet? You don't have to answer that. In any event, as uncomfortable as this may be, certainly it presents to the public a rare but perhaps comforting probe into the judicial mind, and I don't think there's any questions we can stump you with. So, je vais adresser ma question de la langue de Molière, puis je vais peut-être pas parler aussi rapidement que Mme Boivin, parce que c'est certainement pas un encan, mais ma question s'adresse au niveau de l'interprétation judiciaire et dans le contexte de la Charte des droits et des libertés. La Cour suprême du Canada est souvent appelée à interpréter une loi particulière, et en se faisant, elle doit faire son interprétation, une interprétation qui reflète l'évolution des valeurs canadiennes. Ça, c'est surtout dans le cas depuis l'arrivée de la Charte des droits et des libertés. Maintenant, il y a certains qui vont dire que ce processus permet aux droits d'évoluer. De quelle façon pouvons-nous réconcilier cet exercice avec l'importance de maintenir une certaine stabilité et d'assurer en même temps la certitude pour nos citoyens? Not that bad.
C'est une très bonne question. Pas une question facile. C'est pas facile même en anglais. Je sais que la charte rend mon travail comme juge à la fois plus intéressant, mais aussi beaucoup plus difficile, parce que c'est dans le contexte de la Charte canadienne des droits et libertés que les valeurs, il faut mettre en équilibre quelquefois des valeurs importantes, fondamentales, et les valeurs enchâssées dans la Charte. Mais parfois, c'est pas vraiment il y a toujours des règlements. Des règles on doit suivre. Il y a toujours la jurisprudence. Il y a parfois les moyens de trouver un équilibre en protéger les valeurs différentes. Et c'est la stabilité est importante, mais l'évolution est aussi importante parce que la société change et la constitution de après quelques siècles, après quelques décennies, c'est important d'avoir une moyenne aussi d'un changement, mais pas un changement, pour nous, ce n'est pas un changement radical, les changements radicaux sont plutôt pour les législateurs. Pour nous, c'est une évolution d'appliquer les règles dans la jurisprudence, d'avoir un bon contexte factuel, trouver un moyen de respecter les valeurs différentes très important pour les Canadiens et Canadiennes. Je ne sais pas, est-ce que il y a...
Est-ce que j'ai répondu? Je me pose la question à savoir le rôle du judiciaire. Est-ce qu'il va aussi loin que réécrire, là, ou réinventer? Oh. Ou est-ce que c'est plutôt dans le domaine du Parlement où est-ce qu'on trouve la certitude?
Oui. Pour le pouvoir judiciaire, c'est un pouvoir d'appliquer les droits, d'examiner les lois, mais avec les règles, avec les dispositions de la charte, avec la jurisprudence. C'est pas de crier la loi, c'est d'appliquer la loi. C'est pour vous de crier les lois. C'est le pouvoir législatif.
Mr. Harris.
Thank you, sir. Welcome to our committee, and I appreciate that it's a nerve-wracking process for you. I'd say that I've just been appointed only a couple of days ago as the justice critic for the New Democratic Party, so this is a rather swift introduction to this new portfolio for me, but I have been a member of the bar for 30 years, having been sworn in 1980, admitted, I think is what it's called, and have practiced in all of the courts of our country, or all levels of court and many tribunals, so I'm very familiar with some of the stories of your careers, and I'm very interested in your own personal background and the great strides that you have made in your lives to get to here. This process, however, and this process here today has been called, I think one newspaper called it, a gentle grilling. I don't know if I'm going to change the tone of that by my comments, but I do want to ask a couple of questions. Mr. Justice Moldaver, you've been reported to have given what I guess one reporter called provocative speeches to the Canadian Bar Association or the Criminal Justice Association. We're talking 4 or 5 years ago now. And you started to talk about it in answer to one of the earlier questions, but I would like to give you an opportunity to perhaps clarify the situation. You yourself, I understand, sort of came of age as a criminal lawyer after 10 years or so when the Charter was first introduced, and have a sterling record, I understand, for actually being one of the lawyers who brought important challenges under the Charter of Rights in the courts in Ontario, for which I commend you. Yet you, as a judge, have been thought to be discouraging of those kind of applications being brought to the court. And maybe that's why the government liked to point you, I don't know. But can you explain to me and to the those listening and the committee why you made those remarks, and do you actually seek to discourage charter challenges because they clog up the courts and they take up too much time, or you did make some very positive remarks about the importance of the Charter, and maybe you want to reiterate them, though. But it's a little worrisome that you appear to have a reputation for discouraging charter challenges.
Well, thank you for that question. Again, it's a very important question, and to the extent that the label is, I have either purposely or in its effect tried to discourage charter challenges, is, with great respect, completely wrong. I have never discouraged charter challenges, and if you were to look at the addresses in question, I have made it abundantly clear that counsel are perfectly entitled to raise charter matters. And all I really ever wanted to do was just say, just think about these charter applications, because I have been part of the criminal law for now a lot of years, and I have seen criminal trials go from being murder trials 7 days long, sexual assaults 2 days long, to murder trials becoming 7 months long, sometimes years long, sexual assaults going on forever. And I'm not the only one that has talked about this, by the way. The late Chief Justice Lemire was concerned about it. Our present Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Canada has talked about it. The Honourable Mr. Justice Binney, when he just recently talked about it. I just don't want abuses. The people that I was talking about, I was not broad-stroking and never intended to broad-stroke the defense bar. And I say that and I stand by it. That was never, ever my intention. The lecture that I gave, by the way, was the Sapinka lecture. And the Honourable John Sapinka was a great friend and one of the greatest judges in this country. And the lecture was on advocacy. And I took the opportunity to say, in the context of that lecture, that number one, criminal trials were spinning out of control. And part of the problem was charter motions being brought that really there was not a lot of thought being given to. And my first point was, so please be discerning. Don't look at the charter as your own personal genie in the bottle. That's what I said in the talk. But beyond that, the talk was about advocacy. Good advocates do not throw up everything in front of a trial judge and hope that something sticks. That is not good advocacy. In terms, though, of the complexity and prolixity or length of trials, again, with great respect, if you look at what I said I said, this is not a problem that is singular to the defense bar. This is a problem that everybody, all the stakeholders, have to take responsibility for. Crowns, judges, members of parliament, police, everybody that is a part of the system. And I didn't want to throw stones at anybody. I wanted people to come together to make our justice system better, to work better for a common goal. That was what I had in mind. It got, unfortunately, taken the wrong way, and I was accused of being a charter basher and so on and so forth, and I responded. And I responded forcefully because, with great respect, when someone impugns my professional integrity, I'm going to do what I can to restore it. Now, let me just finish with one thing. The main complaint at the time, as I recall it, that everything I'm saying is just anecdotal. It wasn't anecdotal to me. I'm sitting in the appeal court every day, seeing transcripts going up to the ceiling. I knew what was going on. But if there is any vindication needed for the concerns that I have, because 1% of the bar can make a mess of the justice system. Just 1% or 2% or 3%, they can cause a drain on the justice system that is enormous. And if you just please anybody who, if there's any vindication needed, I commend to you the Lesage and Code report, the Honourable Patrick Lesage, Michael Code, now the Honourable Mr. Justice Code of the Superior Court. They made it perfectly clear that what I had described, or what people were accusing me of just talking anecdotally, they made it clear this is not anecdotal. There are some abuses out there, and they have to be dealt with. That said, abuses by the Crown or the police or anybody else have to be dealt with, and including the trial courts and the courts of appeal. We have to be alive to all this. We've got to just work together. My intention was not to demean anybody, certainly not the defense bar that I was a member of for 17 years. I wanted to try and make the justice system a little bit better. That's all that was behind it.
Thank you, Your Honor. And we'll move to Patrick Brown now, please.
Thank you, Minister Nicholson, and thank you, Justice Katsanis and Justice Moldaver, for being here today as part of this open, transparent process. Section 53 of the Supreme Court of Canada Act enables government to reference important questions of law, constitutionality, to the Supreme Court. What do you view is the role of the Supreme Court in the fact that if a government wanted, they could just present legislation on a wait-and-see basis? How do you view Section 53 in terms of the Supreme Court's role?
Start. Obviously, if a reference is brought to the Supreme Court has the obligation to determine the reference. So the decision about whether to bring a reference or not is one for the government. I think maybe even the Senate in some circumstances. But in any event, it's not a decision for the court. I don't have a great deal of experience with references, and I understand that they're relatively rare. And that's probably because every judge will tell you, every trial judge will tell you, every appellate judge will tell you that decisions work best when you've got a full factual context and a full record. That allows you to take the legal propositions and test them against the facts. And that's just the way the law evolves. That's the way that we can apply really quite a rigorous analytical approach as required by the jurisprudence. So obviously there are times when government will feel that an issue is so important, or for some reason there isn't a time to let it come up in the normal way, and that a reference would be appropriate. And obviously the court has to deal with it and deal with it very well. They're all important issues. The other real disadvantage, of course, for the court is you don't have the benefit of the decisions below. And by the time a matter gets to the Supreme Court, usually they will have the benefit of the judge of first instance, of the Court of Appeal, and that reasoning, even if you don't agree with it, that reasoning helps test some of the legal propositions. So I hope I have the opportunity to deal with a reference on the Supreme Court of Canada.
I would just add briefly to that, and I agree with my colleague completely, just to say that there is no hint, from what I can make out, that the section that you refer to has in any way been abused. It's used very rarely, and it's used on matters that are of great, great public importance. And so, to me, much as I have not had any direct experience with the various references that have been before the Supreme Court in the past number of years, it seems to me that it's a very important provision. And used sparingly, I think it can be very valuable.
Madam Justice, you mentioned in your opening remarks about the three branches of government. Do you believe that the executive, legislative, and judicial branches, are they truly equal?
I think they are all equally important. I think they're very important, all of them. Those are the three pillars. That is the foundation of our constitutional democracy, and I believe deeply in them.
I would put it a little bit differently in terms of just to your question, which is an excellent question, but we all have our jobs to do. And if we all do the jobs that we are assigned, then the system and our constitutional democracy will work very well. And if we stray into areas that are not within our responsibility, then we put at risk the essence of our constitutional democracy. So,
do we have any time left? Okay. I imagine the goal of the Supreme Court is to deliver justice, to provide justice. What is your definition of justice? What is your view of justice?
What is your view of justice?
Yes, what is your definition of justice?
You're going to take that one first?
Well, I mean, at one level, and a very simple level, justice to me is having people walk out of the courtroom and feeling that they've had a fair and just hearing. And win, lose, or draw, they know that they have been heard. And they know that the court has taken their matter seriously, and they know that the court has looked at it objectively, and they know that the court has come in not having made up its mind beforehand and given its best assessment of what are often very difficult situations. So that is one definition of justice. But justice to me involves fairness, it involves humanity, it involves having a heart, but it also involves being firm when you have to be.
Thank you.
And I'll go now to Mr. Sandu.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a couple of things in common with Mr. Justice and Madam Justice. I too never imagined that I would be here talking to introducing the nominees to the Canadians. And my family does own a restaurant, although, and it is an Indian restaurant, and I can't boil an egg myself, so let alone 35 people. Again, it's an honor to be here, being part of this process, although. I have many questions regarding this process. I see this committee as an opportunity to introduce yourself and Mr. Justice to Canadians. I don't see this committee as an opportunity for the opposition or the government MPs to grill you. This is more of an exercise where we introduce you to Canadians. I believe the Prime Minister has already made his decision in nominating you, and you know, congratulations on that. Certainly, getting back to the process of how judges are nominated and how they're picked and how they're you know, brought, how you've gotten here, it's not very clear to me. There has been many experts out there in the media, and you've probably read some of the newspapers and stuff, experts, pundits, and many Canadians that are talking about this on the blogs and stuff in regards to the process being not transparent and the process being not accountable. And, you know, some have gone as far as being a partisan process.
part of the reason I think people are talking about that is it's not clear to them what that process is, and it has been sort of behind closed doors. We've had committees made up where they have gone in camera, not really, we can't really find out what happened in there and how it was put together. As a new MP from Surrey, British Columbia, I think it's important for me and Canadians to know, you know, over the years, this process has worked some in some ways because we've had fine Supreme Court justices over the years, and I'm proud to say that we have a very good system in place to get to that. However, there are some shadows, you know, lingering cynics out there, including myself, maybe. How can we make this process more accountable, more transparent, and maybe to cynics, less partisan? I'll let you, Madam Justice, you've had some experience in administrative justice, so I'm sure you'll be able to respond to this.
Well, I'm going to follow Justice Moldaver's advice and not stray into an area that's not mine to decide or determine. Really, the process is not, it's not up to judges to decide what the process ought to be. I'm happy to participate in this process. I'm here. I'm prepared to answer your questions. And as I understand it, though, it has been a process that's been evolving and has involved some rigor in the selection. I was pleased to hear that there was, you know, the selection committee, I think I heard, was unanimous in the shorter list that was prepared. I think it's very important, obviously, that judges have the highest qualifications to serve, and that they have the necessary temperament and experience and expertise and qualifications. And I think that a process that results with judges of the calibers that we've seen is a good process. Whether it ought to be made different or whether it ought to evolve is not a question for me. It's a question for others. I don't know if I've answered your question, but I think the short answer is I really can't answer your question. It's not my job to design the process.
Same question to you, Mr. House Justice.
Well, I agree with my colleague. I mean, and I know of the articles of which you speak, this clearly is something for you, not us. I just say this, though, that the peoples who allow their names to go forward, particularly for this highest position in Canada, you know, I guess the question would be, should their names be public? Should they be exposed publicly? Should they have to go through the while the process is going on, having newspapers and everybody digging into their private lives and so on? It could be quite embarrassing, and it could be quite an invasion into people's privacy. And so I just, it's your process, and we respect it, but I just ask you to consider that there are feelings out there and sensitivities that I think have to be taken into account before we start saying, let's just open all of this up completely, because it is a very sort of sensitive process. I can't add more than that.
Do you have a minute?
You have a minute, yes.
Yes. I'm puzzled myself because I'm not only new to this Parliament building, but House, but I'm also puzzled because I completely don't see the transparency in the process of selecting a Supreme Court judge. You think whether it adds or whether it sort of diminishes the position if there's no transparency or if there's no credibility to your position or when you do become a Supreme Court justice?
There's transparency to a certain extent in this hearing. In terms of keeping abreast the elected members of Parliament of our country, I mean, from what I can understand, I mean, there were people from all the parties on this selection committee, so that certainly Mr. Cromart, and I think you were on this committee, and you could certainly be the conduit to the members of your party. No? Okay. Oh, well, then I didn't even know that. See, it shows what I don't know.
I was sworn, as all of us were sworn to an oath, Mr. Justice Moldaver, we can't discuss what
we're on. Oh, I see. Okay. Well, then I desist. See, I don't even know what the process is. Sorry.
Thank you very much. And any other comments? We'll have to get on a second round there. Mr. Woodworth?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And thank you, Justice Karakatsanis and Justice Moldaver. I can only imagine what you're feeling right now, and I want to just extend to you my appreciation for your attendance here today, and in particular for your excellent opening remarks. Quite frankly, I was a little dismayed at the end of it because you answered so many of the questions I wanted to ask you. I thought you were spot on, and I would like to just, before I ask you anything, comment on what I perceive to be the best thing about this hearing this afternoon, and that is that by opening up your lives to Canadians, you allow those people who are watching and listening to understand how much you have in common, how much they have in common with you. Right from the question of immigrant roots to your youthful work experiences, your favorite TV programs, the fact that you have proud parents and are proud parents, even if I may say, Justice Moldaver, what you've shared with us about leaving a piece of yourself with each case you tried. I think every Canadian, I hope along with me, will say, yeah, that's me too. That's where I come from. And in a democracy, I think it's highly important that the people we choose to make decisions for us share the same roots as most of those in our community. So now, having said that, one of the things that's always intrigued me about judicial decision-making is that two equally fine judges can consider the same facts and legal principles and come to opposite or at least differing conclusions. And we have your list of cases, each of you, and we know that on occasion you've been appealed, on occasion perhaps you've been confirmed, on occasion perhaps you've been overturned. As justices of the Supreme Court, you're going to be in the position of dealing with other judges, and I would be interested to know, when you are going to be reviewing lower court decisions, how are you personally going to approach that, and what are the considerations involved in that? I'll start with Justice Karakatsanis.
Well, it's interesting that you commented on our personal background and our family anecdotes, because I think that is one of the important aspects of this hearing, that Canadians really understand that judges are human. And that's a good thing, because when our decisions impact on people, and I think it's not only important to do the analytical, the rigorous analytical work in reaching a decision, but I, for one, am always testing it. Does this make sense? What kind of an impact is that going to have on people, on communities? Just, does it feel right? Because if it doesn't, I'll go back and I'll think about it again and again and again until I get to a place where it just seems right, both in the head and in the heart too. So that really, I think, describes as well my approach to dealing with appeals from, in my case, people who were my former colleagues not that long ago. And there's always a way that you can explain very clearly, sometimes forcefully, why you are deciding in a certain way, but you don't have to do it in a way that's unnecessarily unkind, or in a way that does not respect the hard work and effort that the trial judge has put into doing their job and making their decision. Why do we sometimes disagree? Well, that's a good question. And I think we all just do the very best we can. And the advantage, I think, in the Supreme Court of Canada is that there are nine colleagues nine judges who are, you know, among like the best jurists in the land, who can sit down together and deliberate and discuss and hopefully find that that common ground that represents the right place, the right decision.
Thank you. Would you comment, Justice Moldaver?
Whenever I was overruled, I always said, well, reasonable people can disagree.
Yes.
And you overruled me.
Well,
and you were right. You were.
Well, I'm not sure. But in any event, reasonable people can disagree. I mean, a lot of the problems that we see are not just black and white. There are shades of gray. And so someone can give a very reasoned set of reasons, a very compelling set of reasons, and someone else can look at it and say, no, that's not right. But I've always been taught that you should never humiliate someone publicly. I mean, it's disgraceful. And to the extent that we have to disagree with a colleague, a former colleague, there's no purpose in making them feel any worse than they're already going to feel when they find out that they have been reversed. And I think that we have to take conscious steps and efforts to temper our language, to temper the way we write our reasons. All of us are advocates in our own way, and I know sometimes when I write a first draft, it has to be toned down because I'm being an advocate in my own way, writing for my position. But we regularly do take steps and show it to colleagues and so on for that very purpose, to make sure that we're trying not to be too hard on whoever the judge may be that has been overruled. That said, if there is a judge who is not following the rule of law on a regular and persistent basis, and we keep seeing the same thing over and over again, and this, I don't want you to think that this happens very often, because it's virtually, we never see it, almost never. But judges are bound by the rule of law, as we said, and if a judge does not comply with his or her oath and does it on a more regular basis, then some sharp language may be required.
With your indulgence, or I'll get some sort of sense from you, colleagues, we're going to move into a second round now. Did you want a break now, or did you want to go right into the second round? These are the shorter questions. Keep on going. All righty. Ms. Heppner.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just have 5 minutes, so I'm going to try to be very brief. I do want to just begin, Mr. Justice Moldaver, you said you were not quite aware of the process by which the shortlist was determined. I just want to say that, from my understanding, the Minister of Justice did consult and he did receive names from across Canada as part of this process. And I also want to say, without betraying any confidentiality that Mr. Kilmartin referred to, that the discussions that we had were extremely collegial and collaborative on that committee. And so, again, you can rest assured that your names, regardless of anything that you might that might be inferred today, both of your names were agreed to unanimously as being part of that list. I want to direct my question. I'm going to start, Madam Karakatsanis, just to see if we have enough time. We have certain individual rights enshrined in Canada in different documents. And there also are collective rights that are also enshrined in certain documents in Canada. And I'm wondering if you would be able to comment, obviously without getting too specific, but how a court of law should address a situation where individual rights and collective rights may come up against each other. What would your opinion be, and your thoughts on that be, Madam?
As I've said previously, I think the Charter is the one area where, certain different values do come into play, and often you can look at the facts and the record, and there may be a way that you can respect all values without, in any way, losing an important value. There is been a body of jurisprudence developed over the past couple of decades that has a analytical framework that first you have to look to see if there's a way that different values can coexist and be accommodated, both of them, so that you can give full effect. There's no hierarchy of values. You have to look at each value in the context of the whole. There may be, if inevitable, and that there will be some give and take, you try to do it in a way that will minimally impair the rights. So there's just a rigorous analytical framework, and you just have to work your way through it. And you work your way through it after you've read all of the facts, the factual context, you've read the documents, you've read the case law, often academic work, and you work your way through it. It's not a situation where you can just stand back and say, well, this is what I feel, because they're all very important rights. And the law requires that we have to go through a process to ensure that we've addressed them as fully as possible without compromising any rights, if at all possible, and if necessary, that it be done in the minimal way possible. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Thank you very much. It does. Does Justice Moldaver have a...
Well, I agree with my colleague, and I would just say this, that if we look at the law, for example, in the criminal law, collective rights, individual rights, and we see it as a spectrum, and on one end we have law and order and we have protection of society, and at the other end of the spectrum we have individual rights and civil liberties. And at various times and places in our jurisprudence, the law might swing a little bit more that way, or it might swing a little bit more the other way. The beauty of Canada, though, is that we are not a country of extremes. There are certain parameters within which we all act. There are certain things that are just simply unacceptable to Canadians. And if the law and order side goes beyond what the courts feel are the proper bounds, then we have to send a message back to Parliament that you've gone too far. But the beauty of our country is that that's not what we're all about as Canadians. And so while someone might be a little upset that the law's gone a little too far this way or a little too far that way, it's always within certain appropriate boundaries. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Mr. Kilmartin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Justice Moldaver, when did you decide that you would like to be a Supreme Court of Canada justice?
Well, I'm not sure I ever really decided it. When I got a call out of the blue and caught me completely by surprise, all I can say is I didn't say that I won't let my name stand. But I can assure you, Mr. Cromartin, that I really never expected to be here. And by the way, that call is in the last several months, so I'm not talking about long before that. And I can also tell you something else, that very honestly, I came from the most wonderful court and come from the most wonderful court in the world. I have great friends, great colleagues, the best people I could imagine. And so my attitude was, if it happens, maybe there's a higher reason, I don't know, and if it doesn't, so be it. But I hope that answers your question. I just learned recently.
When were you advised that you were one of the two nominees?
I'm sorry?
When were you advised that you were one of the two nominees?
I guess it was...
We want to know if it was Mr. Fife who called you because he got a leak on it, or did you get it from the Minister of Justice or the Prime Minister's office?
I hope I'm entitled to say it was October, right after Thanksgiving weekend, and I wasn't really advised. I was about to go into court. I think it was October 7th or October 8th, the Tuesday in any event. Mm-hmm. I was about to go into court, and I got a call, and I thought, well, I'll take it. I didn't know who it was. And the call was, would you be available to speak to the Prime Minister at 4 o'clock today? And I said, I think we'll try and get court done by then. but that was it. That's all I knew. I had no prior knowledge before that.
Madam Justice Karakatsanis, when were you advised?
The same time. In fact, Justice Moldaver came into my office to discuss a case that we were both working on. He looked quite excited. and I didn't know whether he'd gotten a call or not, but I was feeling the same way he was looking.
Were you aware of any of the other final six names?
No, I'm not aware of who they are.
Even to this day?
Even to this day.
Just one question to you again. With your experience, a fairly lengthy experience, in that other pillar of government on the administrative side, has it ever given you any cause for concern when you're making decisions that you may tend to favor a government side over individual plaintiffs or claimants?
Is that to me?
Absolutely.
No, I'm sorry.
No, I think that's directed to me.
Yes.
And the answer is absolutely not. I approach each and every case with the view to doing the right thing according to the law and the facts and the case before me. And sometimes cases turn out differently than you might expect. Sometimes they might turn out differently than you might even have wanted to find, especially on the trial court where the facts sometimes seem to go one way initially and then move. I do not believe that has ever been an influence for me to say there is one party that I favor over another. I take each case as it comes. I do the very best I can in each case, and whatever the right decision is, I'll make it. I will make it. I very much value my integrity, my independence of thought, and I take my oath very seriously.
Thank you. Mr. Justice Moldaver, have you set yourself a time limit as to when you'll be have a fluency, a working fluency in the French language?
Do I? Sorry, I didn't quite hear you.
Have you set yourself a timeline within which you will be fluent in the French language as far as a working knowledge of it?
I can only say this, Mr. Cromartin, I will never make a promise I can't keep. I can promise you that I will try and get at this as quickly as I possibly can. It gives me no joy to be sitting here and you know, feeling that you know, I'm not going to be able for some time to be able to engage in a case in French. So I'll just do the best I can. That's all I can do.
Colleagues and Mr. Deckard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Justice Karakatsanis and Justice Moldaver, I note from your very impressive resumes that you both spent significant periods of time as members of the trial division and then proceeded from there through the Court of Appeal, and here you are today. And I wonder if you could elaborate for us on I'll start with Justice Karakatsanis, on how your long and significant service on the trial division bench prepares you for the Court of Appeal and ultimately Supreme Court of Canada. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about what your biggest challenge was in transitioning from the trial division to the Court of Appeal, and what do you expect your biggest challenge will be in transitioning to the Supreme Court?
Biggest challenge when I was first appointed a trial judge, and that was to keep quiet. You know, I have an outgoing nature. I like to engage people and talk, and I think that the hardest thing for me when I first became a trial judge was just to keep quiet, because, you know, it's hard to listen if you're talking. So that was probably the first thing that I learned as a judge. In terms of challenges going to the Court of Appeal, I think it's natural to miss mm-hmm. kind of the drama and the human experience mm-hmm. that you get in a courtroom. Mm-hmm. And so I know that is something that I miss somewhat, mm-hmm. but only somewhat, because mm-hmm. The job as an appellate court judge is just wonderful, because you get to work with other people. Mm-hmm. So what I don't get kind of in the drama in the courtroom, I have in the ability to talk with my colleagues and work with others. And I have to say that's the aspect of the job that I have enjoyed the most. Also, you get a chance to think about interesting and important legal issues, mm-hmm. and you don't have the pressure of having to make a ruling immediately. You get a chance to reflect.
And if I may, how important, in your view, was your experience as a member of the trial court to looking at the similar cases in the appellate court?
Oh, but was very, for me, it was very important. It was extremely helpful because when you look at an appeal of a trial, is usually one issue when they single. There's one particular ruling or one particular area that's singled out. When you understand the whole dynamics, when you've had the experience, it allows you to see it in context and be able to assess the relative importance of that one area in the context of the entire case. So I found it to be invaluable for me personally as an appellate court judge. Just quickly, in terms of challenges, I imagine that one of the more interesting changes and dynamics for me, I would imagine for all judges who, when they first arrive at the Supreme Court of Canada, is having to have that collegial discussion among 9 members instead of 3. So I imagine that'll be a quite a different dynamic if I'm lucky enough to get there.
Very good. Justice Muldoon?
I'll be very brief. There are some superstars, clearly, that have come directly from practice and who fit right in at the Court of Appeal. Speaking for myself, if you've never charged a jury, you're missing something. And when you're called upon to review jury instructions, it's so helpful to have been there yourself to kind of understand. And I'm going to keep this very brief. The bottom line is, it gave me enormous respect for juries, for people from every common walk of life. Mm-hmm. I have huge respect for juries. I think we laden them with all kinds of complicated legal issues that they fully well understand without us getting into these complexities, and that's something that is of concern. But I have huge respect for 12 people from 12 different walks of life who can come together and bring 500 or 600 years of collective common sense and good judgment. I've been heard to say I would take 12 people of that nature over a single trial judge any day of the week.
Very good. Thank you.
Mr. Cotter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have 2 questions. The first of Justice Moldaver, and if time permits, the second question of Justice Karakatsanis. My question to you, Justice Moldaver, has to do with the area of wrongful convictions. When I was Minister of Justice and Attorney General, I found that this was one of the most important areas of responsibility to review applications for review of wrongful convictions on the grounds of the likelihood of a miscarriage of justice. So you've sat on some of the more important cases in that regard, one of them being one that I referred to your court, and that's the Truscott case. Stephen Truscott, just for the public who's listening in, was convicted of murder in 1959, a conviction upheld by both the Ontario Court of Appeal, Supreme Court, a rehearing in 1969, and reaffirmed the conviction. Now, I grew up as a teenager with that case. I was a teenager when he was first convicted. As a law student, the only aspect I learned about Truscott in a footnote was the capital punishment thing. The issue of wrongful conviction never arose. 45 years later, I was dealing with it as a Minister of Justice and referred that case, also involved in the Filion case. And my question to you, therefore, is what, from your experience, have you learned and can help us on matters relating to wrongful convictions? I'm referring to the importance of issues like eyewitness identification, voluntary and false confessions, the duty of disclosure, due diligence on behalf of defense counsel, etc. You know what I mean? You dealt with it perhaps more thoroughly than anyone I know, and that's why I'm putting the question to you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Cutler, and I know exactly what you mean, and there are certain what I call danger areas that we all have to be alert to. No one wants to see a wrongful conviction. We have to take all reasonable steps to avoid wrongful convictions. It's hard to think of anything worse in our society. So the Kaufman Commission, for example, came out with some very important recommendations in terms of jailhouse informants and so on that have been very helpful to us. The Honourable Peter Corey on eyewitness identification from the Sofano Inquiry gave us some real insights into the dangers of eyewitness identification evidence and how we have to proceed with such care. I know Justice Rosenberg has actually been heavily involved on behalf of the National Judicial Institute in going around the country training judges and talking to them about the various areas that we need to be concerned about and the ones that are liable to give rise to a miscarriage of justice. And I'm going to stop in a moment, but I want to say this. I think the most important decision probably in the history of our charter is the Stinchcombe decision written by the Honourable Justice, late Justice John Sapinka. And I think most of the miscarriage or many of the miscarriages of justice in this country have been because there has not been full and complete disclosure. And the Stinchcombe case obviously made it very clear that disclosure is vital. And if the defense has all the relevant matters, then the chances of there being a miscarriage of justice go down considerably. That was one of the problems, as you know, in the Truscott case. Of course, it's easy to put today's head on yesterday's shoulders, and that really wasn't our purpose, but Stinchcombe case disclosure, absolutely vital. I won't go on. I'm just saying that there are certain areas that we are very much alive to now, thanks to the work of various commissions, thanks to the work of Justice Rosenberg, that we are alerting trial judges to on a daily basis, and all we can do is the best we can. We must never forget, though, it's still a human process, and regrettably, mistakes will be made.
Mr. Kotler, if you don't mind. Mr. Rathkeber.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Obviously, you both have very impressive resumes, but they're very different resumes. And to use your own words, Madam Justice Karakatsanis, you had a somewhat unusual career as a lawyer. I think those were your exact words. So I want to explore that a little bit. I'm curious to get your impression or your perspective as to how your very successful career as a public servant, starting with, I believe, the Liquor Control Board and then with the Attorney General's Office and ultimately being clerk to the Ontario Cabinet, how that experience has helped you as a trial judge, as an appellate court judge, and specifically getting back to what my friend Patrick Brown asked you with the division between the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary.
Well, I think the first thing that I realized when I was appointed a judge was that I was used to making decisions. I was used to making decisions, having to study quickly, as much material as I could get, and reach decisions. And I found on a very practical level that was a big help to me when I first started as a trial judge, and you have to make decisions very quickly. So that took me a little bit by surprise. So that's the one aspect that I still remember quite vividly today. I think that having exposure to how the law works in many different ways is really has really been a gift for me. When you're in law school, you don't necessarily see the law as an instrument of social policy. You don't really see that it impacts on every aspect of our lives. It's the law that determines the relationships, or not determines, but governs relationships between people and between government and people. And I've had the real benefit, I think. Certainly, I've enjoyed it very much, being able to see it from different perspectives that way. So that as an adjudicator with the Liquor License Board, I was involved in administrative law, which is a very different, it's the Liquor License Board, not the Control Board. The Liquor License Board, so as an adjudicator.
I'm from Alberta.
but you know, the administrative justice system is, again, more informal, quicker, a bit more of a policy component than with Native Affairs being involved in land claim negotiations, having oversight for that and seeing how Aboriginal rights were important and had to be addressed. As Deputy Attorney General, not only for oversight for the administration of justice in the courts, specific justice services, you know, witness assistance programs and other justice services, as well, of course, as legal advice. So it was the really the opportunity to see the law and the impact of the law from so many different perspectives, I think, that I've been very fortunate in my career to see that. Now, how has it helped me? I just think having a better understanding of how government works, how laws are made, the care that goes into reaching these important decisions that you make. I've seen firsthand how the public service gives full and you know, really not good nonpartisan professional policy advice. I've seen the public service implement decisions of government, understanding that everybody has a role. It's elected officials who make the decisions, the public service that gives the advice, but then implements those decisions. So it just, for me, has really reinforced the fact that everybody has an important role to play. And we all have to carry out our own roles and respect the roles of the others.
Madame Boivin.
Monsieur le ministre, pour continuer un petit peu sur ce que M. Coumartin vous demandait, M. le juge Moldaver, est-ce que on comprend maintenant, parce qu'on n'est pas très au courant du processus, puis vous autres non plus, à ce que je viens de comprendre, mais vous avez su il y a à peu près 6 mois, si j'ai bien compris, que vous étiez dans le collimateur du gouvernement là, pour devenir possiblement juge à la Cour suprême du Canada. Est-ce que j'ai bien compris que ça faisait peut-être 6 mois que vous saviez que vous étiez dans le...
Non, ma'am, it was in July.
In July.
July that I received the call.
For the first time.
For the first time.
Pour la première fois, vous avez su que... Il était peut-être question que vous soyez à la Cour suprême du Canada. Est-ce que vous avez, à ce moment-là, commencé peut-être vos démarches pour apprendre le français ou si vous attendez, j'essaie de savoir quand est-ce que vous allez commencer cette démarche, vous attendez la confirmation par le gouverneur en conseil ou est-ce que vous êtes déjà dans le processus?
No, I'm not. I have not undertaken steps. That's the simple answer. I have not undertaken steps.
Maintenant, pour Madame la juge, je vais faire un petit peu mon petit démon. Je vais vous demander votre opinion à vous. Est-ce que vous pensez que une personne qui s'en vient plaider devant la Cour suprême du Canada est en droit d'être entendue par les juges? Et par des juges qui comprennent le français ou l'anglais. Donc, est-ce que vous croyez que la Cour suprême du Canada, les juges à la Cour suprême du Canada, doivent être bilingues, fonctionnels?
Moi, je suis contente de pouvoir comprendre les argumentations orales, de lire les documents en français, et je suis, pour moi, c'était quelque chose que j'ai voulu faire, mais j'avais l'occasion aussi dans la fonction publique de l'Ontario d'apprendre le français. J'ai pas commencé comme juge. Mm-hmm. J'ai commencé à l'université et puis dans la fonction publique et j'ai continué mes études. Alors, je suis très contente que moi, maintenant, je peux entendre un appel en français. Si c'est une exigence, si la compétence linguistique est une exigence ou non, c'est pas une question pour moi, c'est pas une question pour les candidats, c'est une question pour vous, c'est une question de politique et je ne peux pas répondre. C'est pas mon domaine.
C'est une réponse. C'est peut-être pas la réponse, mais c'est une réponse. Autant M. le juge Moldaver s'est fait publiquement à travers les médias, alors vous êtes que c'est pas une surprise ce genre de questions que je vous pose. Au niveau public, c'était votre manque de bilinguisme. Autant dans votre cas, Madame la juge, c'était peut-être votre manque d'expérience au niveau cours d'appel, si on veut, parce que c'est quand même assez récent. Qu'est-ce que vous répondez aux gens qui s'expriment là-dessus de cette façon de vouloir faire ce saut vers la Cour suprême du Canada?
Oui. Je commence par dire que j'étais nommée juge maintenant il y a 9 ans, en novembre, ça ferait 9 ans. Alors, dans le cours d'appel, c'est seulement 18 mois. Mais je dois
je dois dire que j'ai trouvé le travail de la Cour d'appel très satisfaisant, très intéressant. Et je pense que j'ai commencé même la première journée avec mes collègues en profitant de la Cour d'appel. Je dois dire que quelquefois, il y a des candidates ou candidates pour la Cour d'appel qui n'étaient pas jamais un juge de procès. Et quelquefois, à la Cour suprême du Canada, sans une expérience de la Cour d'appel de tout. Mais je dois dire que je suis très honorée d'être ici et je vais faire le meilleur que je peux si je suis nommée à la Cour suprême du Canada.
Merci.
And now my colleague, Monsieur Gauguin.
I'd like to canvass both your thoughts on the role of experts at the appellate level. Oftentimes, I mean, the facts are all before you, obviously. There's not supposed to be any new evidence being introduced, but more and more so, cases are a very complex nature. Do experts have a role at the appellate level, and what kind of procedure would you envision in their use to be able to arrive at a comprehensive decision faced with very technical-type decisions to be made?
Well, I just answered a very important question. Is it designed to say that perhaps we should have experts sitting listening to the appeal, or that we should be going out and getting expert evidence? I mean, our system is primarily based on the parties, of course, putting forward to the court.
I'm thinking more of the court marshalling the experts to kind of assist them in interpreting highly technical information, of course. I mean, that can obviously be viewed as being somewhat unfair, but there has to be some sort of a role for experts.
Sure.
We can't be experts in everything, obviously.
Clearly, we can't. It's not proper for us to go outside the record. We can't start calling up experts and saying, what does this mean or what does that mean? That would be, you know, highly improper. We could, I suppose, in a particular case, encourage the parties to perhaps try and file some fresh evidence before us if we're into a situation where the record at the lower level is not complete, and we could perhaps hopefully enhance the record in a way that would assist us. But
based on consent, of course.
I'm sorry?
Based on consent.
Based on consent, absolutely. But beyond that, we're pretty much bound by the record that we get, and hopefully there will be kind of expert evidence that will assist us in writing our reasons. What I found, though, it's remarkable about this whole process is that, you know, somebody on the court knows something about something. I mean, and we all can't know everything about everything. I mean, at age 20, I thought I knew everything about everything. Today, I realize every day how little I know about so much. So, but there are other people, and we talk and so on, and the collegiality, and you work it through. You do the best you can.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gauguin. And Mr. Harris.
Thank you, sir. Madam Justice Karakatsanis, I have a question, which I'll try to put delicately, but it's in the public domain, so I'm repeating something that's already out there, but I do note that your experience is a little different than others. You have a strong public law background, which I think is good, but your experience on the Court of Appeal is a year and a half, although I do note that you, of the 27 cases that you sat on with your colleagues, you wrote 10 of the decisions, so I'm not, the work ethic is obviously clearly there. But, you know, some of your, of our legal confreres, and I'm not talking about partisans, I'm talking about law professors and some commentators, said, well, you know, they've overlooked some big brains on the Court of Appeal in Ontario, and she's not got this much experience. And some of them go so far as to name the other people who are sort of perhaps more qualified by their experience and whatnot, almost given the sense that you're jumping the queue here somehow. And I want to know, first of all, how does that make you feel as a person now going to the Supreme Court of Canada? And how do you respond to that in terms of what it is that you bring to the table here?
Well, how does it make me feel? I have to say that I feel very humbled. As Justice Moldaver said, any one of our colleagues on the Ontario Court of Appeal would be fabulous in the position. So I feel very, very honored to be here, very humbled to be here. In terms of my experience, it is somewhat different. I acknowledge that I have not been on the Court of Appeal for as long as I probably would like to be. It's a fabulous, fabulous place to work, and the colleagues are, without exception, extraordinary people to work with. But I feel honored to be here. I believe that I would do what I've done every time I've faced a new job, which is do the very best I can, work really hard. In those areas where I need to work harder, I would work harder. I have to say that I feel that it's been an intense, rewarding experience on the Court of Appeal. And as I said to Madame, I think it's Maître Boivin, sometimes people are appointed to the Court of Appeal who have not been trial judges. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people are appointed to the Supreme Court of Canada who've not been judges at all.
Oh, I agree.
I'm just feeling quite honored to be here.
I think your answer to Mr. Rathgerber in terms of your extensive public law experience and what that brings to the court is also extremely important. And that's what I thought your answer might be, that this is equally important in many respects, of having experience as a clerk of the executive council and in government, that's a perspective that many judges do not have and that you do bring to the court. So,
well, thank you for that. That's an excellent answer.
I'm trying to help you out here.
I should have said that myself. Again.
I have time for on this one. Mr. Brown.
Minister Nicholson, we've touched a little bit on property rights. What is your view of property rights in Canada and the protections that exist? For maybe Justice Karakatsanis first.
It's kind of hard to answer questions like this in the abstract. Mm-hmm. I think every judge will tell you that we do best on a case-by-case mm-hmm. basis. Is there a particular issue that you're thinking about?
In terms
about?
Of balance, do you believe we have an adequate balance in terms of the protection of property and property rights in Canada?
I guess I'll just stay with my first answer and say that it's really hard. I mean, we have property rights, but when you're talking about balancing them, I'm not sure in what respect. So it's just judges find it very hard to answer, general hypothetical questions. We're used to.
It's whatever you're comfortable with, Your Honor.
Yes.
This is what we're here for.
Thank you.
Okay. Any further comments or questions?
Yeah. The other question, Minister Nicholson, is in regards to the high cost of litigation. There's other things that have been introduced in the court system, like alternative dispute resolution. How do you believe, or any comments or thoughts on your views on the high cost of litigation and mechanisms available that might enable us to reduce those costs?
You want me to do that?
Justice Moldaver?
Well, that's a very, very important and topical issue. It's been said before, and I'm not the first to say it, that but there are some who feel that we have a justice system that only the very rich and the very poor can access. And the middle class is largely shut out because who can afford? Who gets charged with a criminal offense that has to go to trial for 10 days or 2 weeks and is not legally aided and has to pay the kinds of fees for the preparation and so on, you would virtually be bankrupt. Virtually be bankrupt if you had to finance that. You'd lose your house and everything else probably. Legal aid obviously is in stress most of the time, but it's just a vital part of ensuring that people can access the courts and access justice. And so one of the questions earlier was my talk about the length and complexity and prolixity of trials and so on, and not wanting people to abuse the system, not wanting people to use the charter to obstruct and delay, because every time a judge is doing a case, take for example a case that could be done in 2 months, if it takes 4 months, that's 2 months that the courtroom is not able to be accessed by someone else, that's 2 months that a judge is out of commission, that's 2 months of legal aid funds that could be being used for family law matters, for other significant immigration issues and so on. And so we all got to work towards that, towards having an efficient, effective justice system and a properly funded, hopefully legal aid system that can try and cope with all of the demands and all of the various factions that are looking for what probably is a relatively small piece of the pie. But there's a real concern that many Canadian citizens are feeling an inability to actually access our justice system, and that is something that we have to get at and get at quickly.
Mr. Sandhu, any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Justice Moldaver, you've talked about the jury, having a lot of respect for the jury.
Yes.
And I want to talk about that a little bit. I've often heard that when, you know, through media and also watched TV and other sources, when the judge is given instruction to the jury, it's often very technical, long, and it's tedious.
And tell me about it.
For a layperson, would you care to sort of elaborate on that?
Well, it's been said for years and years and years that 90% of what we tell juries is for the Court of Appeal and 10% is for the jury. And I've heard that, and I've heard that for years, and ever since I've been a judge, and nothing seems to change. And so I'm going to speak very briefly to that, and I think we have to make every effort to try and come to grips with the fact that we are dealing with 12 people from 12 different walks of life who just didn't arrive here yesterday, and I think we should be looking to try and streamline our instructions to the jury with that in mind, and try and remove some of the complexities that exist and that we see as trial judges when you're in the middle of full flight trying to explain the co-conspirator exception to the hearsay rule to a jury, and their eyes are glazing over and you're falling asleep giving the instructions. I used to, when I was charging on self-defense sometimes, it was so complicated, I would say to the jury after a recess, I'd finish maybe 34-1 and they'd come back and we'd start in on 34-2 and I'd say, thank you very much for coming back. and really, there are things that can be done and in my respectful view should be done.
Justice Moldaver,
yes.
I'm not a lawyer myself, but I'm going to use it in a legal term here. What's the remedy for that? How do we fix it? Like you talked about generally, but what are some of the things we can do?
I think we have to put our best legal minds together. I think we have to get parliamentarians into the business, the game too, shall we say. I think all the stakeholders have to come together and work with a common goal constructively. I think we can do it. I'm sure we can do it. But you have to kind of get everybody on side, and or you have to just have the judges start to just take the bull by the horn, so to speak, and just lead the way, I guess, and sort of through our judgments try and make it clear that these kinds of long winded, complex charges are no longer acceptable, and that we should be paring them down and giving the jury just what they need, but no more than what they need. So,
got a question from Madam Justice. You talk about Canada being a diverse nation, and myself being an immigrant, I came to this wonderful country 31 years ago, and I can't thank enough for the opportunity that this land has given me. You come from a diverse background yourself, and having learned a number of different languages, grew up in a very large family. How is that diverse background of yours is going to help you to do a better or a good job or a better job, or how can that be? How can that experience be used? How you're going to be using that experience?
Well, I'll start with what I said in my opening statement, that I think that my immigrant heritage has helped me to be a little more sensitive to different cultures, to understand diversity a little bit more, the challenges that immigrants face. I think it helps, I think, in terms of empathy, understanding that people come from different places, they have different views, different perspectives. It's another way of having an open mind, really. So I think that it just is so much a part of who I am that it's hard to say it's going to help me specifically in one way or another. It's really just about respecting people for their differences, as well as celebrating what we have in common.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Justices, the professor at the beginning outlined for us why it is that we can't ask you questions about explaining your past decisions. We can't put you in a box by trying to ask you what you might do in relation to any future issue. And yet it is for us on behalf of Canadians to take your measure in some way without those opportunities. And it's always seemed to me that one way to take the measure of a person is to understand what ideals they aspire to. So I would like to ask each of you, what do you consider to be the most important qualities of an ideal Supreme Court justice, keeping in mind the unique responsibilities of that position? And this time, since I started last time with Justice Karakatsanis, I'll start this time with you, Justice Moldaver.
Well, thank you very much, and that's an excellent question. I mean, I come back to humility, understanding what we're all about. I mean, I'm not a fancy person. I don't pretend to be a constitutional scholar. I don't pretend to be a scholar in any areas of the law. Criminal law is an area that I've lived with for many, many years, but I still have to learn every day and do learn every day. So I think humility is important. I think, and when I say humility, what I'm really saying is that take the job very seriously, but don't take yourself too seriously. We are all cogs in a very big wheel. You've heard the expression judgeitis before. That is something that I have no time for, judgeitis. And quite frankly, if you want to know how important you are, I tell this to new judges, walk outside of Osgoode Hall onto Queen Street and try and butt into the lineup at the chip truck at noon hour, and you'll see how important you are. And if you want to think how handsome you are or beautiful you are or how funny you are and so on, because all these things happen when you become a judge, your jokes are very funny and you're beautiful and so on, just ask your 14-year-old daughter. She'll tell you. Now, I mean, the bottom line is that we're all very human. And if we have a kind of an understanding of the human condition and an empathy for the human condition, that we respect the basic fundamental values that make Canada such a wonderful country, that's what goes into, in my view, the making of a good judge.
Justice Karakatsanis, you have a bit of a hard act to follow.
It is. It's hard to top that, but I mean, I concur.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, yeah, we'll have a unanimous decision on that. Professor Hogg, any comments?
No, I don't want to add to the discussion. I just want to thank everybody today for their courteous, moderate, and civil approach to this. I think it's been a credit to everybody, with great respect. And of course, I was glad I wasn't the candidate myself. It's not an easy job, but obviously the two candidates did a wonderful job.
Colleagues, let me just thank all of you around this table and all of those who helped put this together, and you, Professor Hogg, thank you for being a part of this. And to the two nominees, thank you very much for opening up about yourself and your vision of this. I think you're going to be a great part of the fabric of this country. So you said you and your families are so proud of you being here. I can tell you all of us are very proud. Thank you very much. Thank you.